Commissioner Howard, you have prayer today.
Heavenly Father, we ask you today to bless this board and to give us wisdom, understanding, and respect for each other as we do your work in our community. We also ask that during this holiest time of year that we look out for one another. We look for those that are less fortunate than we are, ways to help them to make sure that they're clothed and homed or have homes and food, and that we work together as a community as we go into the new year. We ask this in Jesus' name, amen.
Place the flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, start off with positively, Carol.
I'm over here now. That's positive.
You're too close.
Just when I was getting used to things on the left, now I've got to get used to things on the right.
You're just. Yeah, I have some positive with Carol.
So
last week we had Wreaths Across America at Deer Park United Methodist Church. That was a phenomenal event. Very cold, but I think they put it was one of the places in Maryland chosen to participate in that program to honor our veterans. And a very nice event. I think they put 147 wreaths on graves at that point. And yesterday, we have a new business in town, Absolute Investigative Fingerprinting and Social Services, had a ribbon cutting.
Security services.
Yeah. Anyway, they had their ribbon cutting and opened up, taking up many of the services that the Sheriff's Department, school system, fingerprinting needs. So, nice event, well attended. So, welcome to Carroll County.
Thank you.
Yeah, I think I'm going to plug another business which has been pretty much off the radar screen, but we have a local firearms training business right here in Westminster, 19 North Court Street. It's called Geared Up Firearms Training and Accessories. It's run by John and Donna, and I told them that I would talk a little about them. They offer both firearms products and courses, training courses, qualification courses for handgun licenses, self-defense courses, shotgun courses, NRA rifle courses, and they sell ammunition, cleaning supplies, range gear, optics, and holsters. And they say they're cheaper than the big box stores, they say. And again, they're at 19 North Court Street, Geared Up Firearms Training and Accessories right here in Westminster. And while we're on the topic, this will be our last meeting before Christmas. So I think on behalf of the entire Board of Commissioners, I'd like to wish our entire county a Merry Christmas, Happy Hanukkah, and Happy Holidays to all of you. And please stay safe. Enjoy your families, and be nice to each other.
Thank you. Anything else?
Sure, I have a couple things. Last Friday, I had the honor to be in Manchester. And we have a tremendous partnership with BGE. And, you know, lots of folks focus on their bills. And forget about the fact that BGE gives back to the communities in many, many, many ways. And one example of that happened on Friday when they donated, gosh, how much, Steve? About $60,000, right?
At least that's a conservative figure, probably more than that.
Right. Town manager Steve Miller was there, who's also a member of the Manchester Fire Department, but they donated to Manchester and Lineborough Fire Departments a ton of excellent equipment, self-contained breathing apparatus, lockers for turnout gear, racks for bottle. I mean, it was just endless. The trucks kept pulling up, or there was so much on the truck there that, you know. So unfortunately, it didn't get covered by the local press, and I hope we can do that at some point. The Carroll County Times wasn't there, unfortunately. But I know BGE put a press release out. But that's a positive thing. And
made a lot of volunteers happy.
It did. So kudos to BGE for that. And again, that's just one example of what they give back. I know several departments got grants last year also through their program. So remember the folks at BGE and how they do give back to our communities. That was some really good stuff over there. Many of us have been attending events throughout the county over the last week or two. I went to the Union Bridge Business Association event the other evening, and went to the Tawnytown Senior Center yesterday and had my sixth turkey and dressing meal of the 2-week period. But just a point, we are so blessed in Carroll to have the organizations that we have, the nonprofits that we have, our fire departments, and it's just this time of year you count your blessings, and certainly I'm thankful for everything that goes on in Carroll and the great people that make up all of these organizations. So kudos to everybody, and again, I'll echo Commissioner Rothschild and say have a great holiday season. Merry Christmas to everybody. And the biggest thing is to be safe out there. Make sure you watch one another and check in on your friends and neighbors, especially if it gets cold. I think they're calling for snow on a little bit of snow on Christmas Eve or something. So
I think they changed that forecast.
They did?
But it changes day to day. So
I thought maybe Santa could slide in. Right. Of course, I'm not privy to Santa like you are, so I'm going to pass it to you.
Gee, thanks.
You're welcome.
Yeah, I'll just say real briefly, yesterday I had the challenge or opportunity to do some business up in New York City and drove up there, and it's been a long time since I've driven around New York at 4 o'clock in the afternoon, and after being on the Jersey Turnpike and coming on down and everything else, there's something about hitting that entering Carroll County sign that is just so warm and welcoming. And so I think in all of our discussions as we go forward with planning and zoning and different things, it's important to remember that we've got this great community, and we ought to make sure that all of our decisions reflect it. We want people to always have that feeling, whether they're out for a day or they're coming back once in a while, that sign that says entering Carroll County is a big deal.
Right.
Was for me yesterday, anyhow. So.
All right, thank you. Yeah. And I guess that's it. So we'll move on to our first item, which is Hampstead Annexation Number 41. We have Linda Eisenberg and Claire Stewart.
Good morning.
Morning.
Good morning.
Good morning, Commissioners. Again, thank you for your patience with us this morning and your time. We have quite a few agenda items before you. This is the first of the next four agenda items. And this is Claire Stewart, our planning technician. She's been doing our annexations since we had a departure of a staff member, so this has been reassigned to her recently. And I believe this is her first time before the board with you. And she's going to give a presentation about the Patmos property and the annexation request for Hampstead. So we are here today to brief you on Hampstead Annexation Number 41. This is the annexation plat that we received from the town of Hampstead on November 17th. The area to be annexed is 36 acres, and it's a combination of two parcels. The larger parcel is parcel 414. And it is roughly 32 acres. And then this smaller sliver right here is roughly 4 acres. So a total of 36 acres. right here is the town of Hampstead. And The gray hatched area is everything inside the corporate limits. The red and black dashed line shows the growth area boundary. And this blue outline is the area to be annexed, just south of the town. Here is the same map, just on a larger scale. Once again, the outlined area in blue is the area to be annexed. And the growth area boundary, it is in the growth area boundary. And the gray hatched area is the corporate limits. Here is an aerial of the area to be annexed. So the zoning, under the county zoning, all 36 acres are restricted industrial IR. The area right inside of the town that meets the area to be annexed is also IR. And
the town's IR.
Right. And this little sliver right here, this is SHA-owned property. It was the former roadbed for Doss Garland Drive, and it's currently a grass strip right now, so it's not being occupied. Under the Hampstead designated land use, the SHA-owned property is designated as resource conservation. The larger parcel, the front portion that fronts South Main Street or Maryland 30 is business general, and the rest of the 21.9 acres is IR. The resource conservation is 3.7 acres, and then the BG would be 10.5 acres. As always, we ask for agency comments from the following bureaus or departments. And we have received two comments. The first is from the Bureau of Utilities. And their comment, they stated that the area to be annexed has no existing sewer infrastructure. And although they are in the priority 0 to 6 year time frame, there is no guarantee on the time or the infrastructure. And they just wanted to make that clear. And then we also received a comment from the Bureau of Development Review acknowledging that there is a communications tower on the site. Today, we are asking for no action. We will be back in front of you again on January 4th. For discussion and decision.
And this is when we do our comment letter. So we don't anticipating any more comments to be received regarding this annexation. So as always, we will package up the comments we already currently have into a letter for you to forward to the town.
All right. Any questions?
Property owners been notified?
This is, as always, annexations are property owner driven.
Okay.
So the property owners are requesting that this parcel be annexed in.
Thanks.
You familiar with this, Dick?
Yes, very familiar, and I don't think there'd be a whole lot of opposition to it.
Okay.
I mean, I notice you're coming back on January the 4th.
Correct.
I have previous engagement that day, will not be here, but I am have no objection to this.
Okay. Yeah.
All right.
Okay, great.
Okay.
All right, thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Okay, item two. Item two, Manchester Municipal Growth Element. And Ms. Linda Eisenberg again, and Bobby Moser.
So we're here before you today. Again, this is more for our process and procedure to get a letter of support for the town of Manchester for the proposed changes to their municipal growth area boundary. As you recall, we were before you last week, as well as representatives from the town who are here today again. So the town manager, Steve Miller, the consultant, Mr. Schumacher, and the town administrative assistant, Michelle Wilder, are here today to represent if there's any additional questions regarding this municipal growth area boundary change. As requested from our last time, a more zoomed in, blown up map for your clarification of the town of Manchester's comprehensive plan and growth area. And we also have it on screen in a larger format as well. So again, what we were requesting to be forwarded for the comment letter was that regarding Chapter 7, which is their municipal growth area extension, that 19 areas being included in the 2008 Manchester Comprehensive Plan, 11 of the remaining 15 proposed areas, most of which are enclaves, were requested from Carroll County Planning staff to be included in the municipal growth area. And those are the parcels that are internal. And Bobby's going to just zoom in, show you on the map. Those
where
are
is
all.
It? You want me to
just, no, just point to the cursor.
I can find the cursor.
So parcel F, E, D, L, so all of the internal
over
parcels
here.
Staff requested being included into the municipal growth area boundary. The Planning Commission did review this on November 21st and did forward a favorable recommendation to the board. And it is the town's, as the board's understanding, that the town will retain the current local business and general business designations within the municipal growth area for areas C and G.
Do you know this one right here? C, that little area right there.
That's C.
And then and for G, it was this little
and
area
this little
right
sliver
here.
For G.
So in other words, when you look at the county master plan map, the future land use designation for these two proposed municipal growth areas is partially residential and there's also business. We are requesting that they retain the business land use designation for these two areas, and town staff has agreed to do that.
So that's all we have for you. So if you're agreeable to forward the comment letter, that's what we're here for today.
I'd like to move the board approve the letter of agreement from the county to the town of Manchester.
So motion, do you have second?
Second.
Second.
Okay,
any
great.
Other discussion?
No, you're good. Steve, you're good. I mean, you're all good with this, right?
I would like to commend your staff. Your staff.
Come up to the mic, Steve, so that.
Especially if you're commending.
Yeah, especially if you're commending. You know.
That loud comment.
That's right. We asked you to go through that door right there. Right?
Commissioners, I'd like to commend your staff on the assistance that they have given us over this process. It's a long, tough process. And we appreciate everything that you've done for the town staff and our consultant. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And I do want to mention that GIS staff upstairs has been working with Mr. Schumacher, the town's consultant, who is helping the town develop the draft comprehensive plan update. And Jim has told me that the cooperation with the GIS staff doing the maps, including this one, has been very, very good.
Excellent.
Okay.
Very good.
All right, we have a motion and a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Zero. Thank you.
Good job.
Thank you.
Nicely done.
Thank you, Commissioners. Have a good Christmas.
You too.
Thanks, Steve. You too.
God bless.
Okay, move on to the next item, comprehensive rezoning, code revision, concepts, timeline, marketing, and outreach efforts.
I'm still
Linda,
here. You got me for a little bit longer.
Chris Swam is coming up. Mary Lane. Oh, I see. Oh, okay. She's staying back.
Yeah. Oh, join me in the front.
Oh, she came up. All right. I had the extra chair. Why not use it?
I'll drive when you're ready.
Yes, what's up in the presentation from last week really quickly? So this is part three of our three-part series regarding the comprehensive rezoning efforts. And Commissioner Wance, I think you've been spared the first two, so you get the honor and privilege of being here for the last but not least.
And I'll answer you in the form of a question. Thank you.
You might be. So what we have been discussing over these last several weeks are the efforts that staff under your direction have undertaken regarding the comprehensive rezoning efforts for the county following the 2014 Comprehensive Master Plan adoption. This has been a huge Herculean effort by many staff members to begin to draft revisions to the text and then eventual map changes that will occur once all the plans are adopted for the Freedom Area and the text has been adopted by the Board of County Commissioners. So one of the first things we brought to you were the concepts that the concept team developed through their discussions of rules that they were following in the development of the draft code. So those were to update regulations that best fit Carroll County, revise purpose and intent for all districts, eliminate specific use structures where possible, utilization of a table format rather than current enumerated uses for each district. And again, this is that use table format where, especially for the commercial, industrial, and employment campus, you'll see it be one-stop shopping. So you would be able to see what districts your particular commercial or industrial use would or would not be allowed in, or if it would be allowed, but with the conditional type of approval, which will make it much easier for the property owners or developers.
That was yesterday when you were traveling.
Yeah.
He's still stuck in New York.
Sorry, Linda.
It's fine. Priority of highest and best use, creation of new uses, and elimination of obsolete uses to reflect current market trends. Our zoning code had not comprehensively been updated, though we do a lot of text amendments, but it hasn't had a comprehensive revision since its inception. So this was to just clean up a lot of old things that have been on the books that we don't have any longer, and adding new types of industries that are now current to today's market. Creation of new definitions and refinement of existing definitions for consolidation, clarification, and modernizing again these uses. To discuss accessory uses and how they would be utilized, fewer conditional uses in the Industrial 2 district, which is our general industrial, and then also discussions of bulk requirements. So these are just general concepts that the concept team, as we developed the code, would be looking to follow these guidelines.
Just as a clarification, the title of the slide, Comprehensive Rezoning Concepts Review, this is for industrial and commercial, these 10.
Well, those are the only ones that we've developed thus far, but we would be using a similar premise moving forward with residential conservation.
Because highest and best use could drive residential decisions that are inconsistent with the way we've traditionally developed in this county. I wouldn't be supportive of using a highest and best use criteria for residential.
I don't think that one is intended for residential. That's talking more about the cascading uses, that the least intense goes all the way to the most intense, mm-hmm. even if it's not appropriate in the commercial and industrial.
Okay, so this slide, just for the public record, are 10, what we call them, philosophies? What are you calling these things?
We were calling them concepts, but philosophies, rationale.
Rationale for industrial and commercial. It's not your intention to apply these 10 to residential. It would be different 10.
I'd imagine they would be, but we haven't begun those discussions with the concept team, so I don't want to speak for how that will flesh out for the residential conservation and ag, but right now the intent from this was for the commercial and industrial.
Okay, so if we approve this, it's only for for commercial and industrial if we approve this.
If that's your desire, then it can be. Okay. An employment campus.
Okay, thank you.
Or could we just designate that one item and the other one's applicable?
I mean, 9 is fewer conditional uses in the I-2, so that, again, would be just really applicable to the industrial.
Right. I'm saying if you adjust the number 5 to say highest and best use in commercial industrial, you know.
Okay, we can add that.
So that way it could be universally applied.
Yeah, and there's no question about that one.
That would be better. Thank you.
Okay.
And that way you don't have to come back for another set of.
Absolutely.
Not that we don't like seeing you, but.
Moving forward.
You know, yeah, that's right.
So I think that was the first item, and I didn't know Roberta, you wanted to approach a motion for that before we move on.
So do you want to hear the whole thing, and the only motion they're really asking you for is specifically related to these. So mm-hmm. do you want to just, if the board's willing to make a motion on this, and then hear the rest, or do you want to?
Right. Do you have any more questions about these concepts?
Not presently.
All right. Does anybody have a motion to accept the concepts?
I'll move that we accept the concepts for, and this is for the, we're accepting the concepts for the group.
This was the direction that the concept team took in developing the commercial, industrial, and employment campus districts.
New zoning text.
And again, the idea was that, so you all understood the premise by which these were being developed and to make sure it concurred with your thoughts on how you wanted this text to move forward.
No, I get that, but I mean, we're saying we're approving these concepts for that group to use. Is that what we're...
Correct.
And you're calling them, what is it, what is the group actually being...
It's concept team.
The concept team, okay. All right, so I'll make a motion that we approve this comprehensive rezoning concepts for the concept team, subject to the change that we discussed on number 5 that it reflect commercial industrial use.
We have a motion. We have a second.
Second. And while I'm seconding, I will... You did point out that I didn't see this before, but I have looked at these in my absence from open session before and went over all of this. So just wanted to make that clear on the record.
All right. Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed?
Zero.
Thank you.
So I think there was the timeline on here, too.
Oh,
no. Oh, yeah,
no.
I'm sorry.
Okay, the rest of this is just for briefing purposes.
Correct.
Okay. You can relax.
You're gone.
You're telling them to relax.
You're gone. There you go.
All right.
So the next thing under this issue, again, just to kind of reiterate, so thank you for concurring and making that motion, because that gives staff the assurance that we're moving forward in the appropriate manner with the development of these zoning code revisions. And I just wanted to go over again the timeline, which just keeps us on our timeline moving forward. So again, as you all are well aware, the commercial and industrial have been drafted. We are still working on drafting the employment campus text, and we are now going to begin the process of forwarding these draft text amendments to the Planning Commission. And so hopefully on January 3rd we'll have full packets prepared, and we've made time on their agenda to distribute these text amendments to them, so we can begin that public discussion and begin to do citizen outreach with regards to the zoning text amendments. So that's why I have Chris here today, and I want to thank him and Chris Weinbrenner, as well as the GIS staff downstairs and others in the county who have really gotten behind this and have really been working with staff from the concept team level to planning staff and to these fine folks, helping us develop a public outreach and marketing campaign to get the word out to property owners that we are looking at the zoning code revisions, and here's what we're doing, and here's how you can continue to be aware of the process, and how we are going to continue to do outreach and have host meetings and work with the citizens on this outreach effort. So I'm going to let Chris start with his impressive presentation.
Got a lot of faith.
I do. I saw it. It's great. So one thing that we felt was really important in this process, starting it from the beginning, was to brand this effort. So when citizens, property owners see this logo, when they see the tagline, they know what it means. They know what to expect, that this is something that's important to them, important to the county, and to pay attention, because this deals with our zoning and how land is utilized within Carroll County. So one thing that we've done is we've developed a website. We haven't launched it yet, but we'll be launching this hopefully soon after the first of the year. But we have a carrollrezoning.org website. This will be your one-stop shopping for anything regarding the comprehensive rezoning effort until its completion. So we've obviously purchased the URL for carrollrezoning.org, and this will act as our information distribution center. So again, pending how we have an outcome for today, given your concurrence to move forward, this is what we're ready to launch with this effort. Also, we're going to be utilizing the Carroll Connect, which is our delivery service for our mass emailings for notifications. So anyone who has signed up for any of the topics, hopefully they'll be signed up for the zoning topic, will get an email regarding this effort. And Chris, can you just explain a little bit who this will go out to first and then how they subscribe?
Certainly.
Thank you.
We will do a Facebook social networking campaign for people to sign up once we initiate carrollrezoning.org. Once the website's up, the website will have a connection to subscribe to that. So any information as it's updated will go out through that email as you if you've signed up to subscribe for that particular topic. And that's already created, and we're just waiting. Once everything's live, we'll make that available for people to sign up.
What about if they're not signed up on the website? How are we getting information?
So, good question. That's our next slide.
Okay.
Did you see this already, Weaver? Is that why you asked that question?
He's prompting me. He
no,
knew.
No, I was just... yeah.
Okay. So for the low-tech approach, just to get the word out, we are going to be doing a mailing to approximately 50,000 properties in Carroll County with a postcard mailing to let them know that this is happening. Can you actually back to one side? So the, actually this is the back. Well, we'll switch order. I'm sorry, Chris.
Yeah, you weren't doing the front.
Sorry, so this is the front of the postcard that will introduce what it is they'll be seeing. Sometime in January, we're hoping to have these mailed out right after the new year. And it'll be an inviting letter from the Board of County Commissioners as to why they should be paying attention. And I'll just read it because I think it's really nicely written. We're trying to keep this very positive and upbeat. This is meant to be, that's meant to really help property owners and citizens understand our code better and make our code more user-friendly. So it says, Dear Carroll County resident, we have some exciting news. Carroll County is updating its zoning code, so hopefully just the planning people don't find that exciting and interesting. It's everyone. Our current zoning code was written in 1965, and it's starting to show its age. And then we give some bits about 1965, that Lyndon B. Johnson was president, a gallon of gas cost 25 cents, and the average house cost less than $20,000. Times have changed, and it's time for an update. We are excited to work with you throughout this process. We want to hear from you. Please stay tuned for future announcements, and then we lead them to the website for carrollrezoning.org. And then this is from you, the county, Carroll County Commissioners. And then on the back, it explains why it's time to rezone and who this really involves, because this is not for the municipalities. This will only pertain to those living outside of a corporate limit. We do not have land use authority or jurisdiction over our incorporated municipalities, so it's the balance of the county, which is approximately close to 50,000 properties. So this is, if you're a Carroll County resident living outside of a municipality, this may affect you. And what we're doing is rewriting the old zoning code. When? Well, now, the process is beginning now. And then how to stay informed. And Chris will get into more of how we're gonna do some other approaches that will get to the masses. But attend a meeting near you. We're our planning meetings throughout this process, hopefully with our first meetings beginning at the end of January, beginning of February, to roll out to the commercial and industrial and employment campus districts. Then to also come to our website, sign up for updates at Carroll Connect. Call us, the Department of Planning. This is what we do. This is what we're here for. So giving out our information. Any one of our planners can answer questions. We've all been involved in this process. Or email us as well. Public participation is critical. We do need the public's involvement. We want to hear from them. And that's how we're going to ensure the success of this effort. And then we also added a QR code. So if you have that on your mobile device, you can scan it without having to memorize any of this, and it'll take you right to the website with this information.
Excellent.
Wow.
So this is Chris's area of expertise, so I'm gonna scoot back and let him take over.
So we'll start with, once the website is live, postcards have been sent, we'll do an outreach through our press release system, the county social networking outlets, the government access channel, Channel 24 on Comcast, and of course our digital signage, which is in the senior centers and of course downstairs. And that will be all using the consistent brand so that everything is all the same message. We were already in the process of creating motion graphic productions, short pieces to describe what we're doing, and we're going to be doing some public service announcements also. They will be also produced for the campaign starting in January. Everything is kind of getting set up and ready to hit the switch and go live at this point. So we're also looking at possibly working with our Carroll County Public Library system with their digital signage that they have in their libraries. And of course, we're hopefully going to be able to use the Carroll County Public Schools email notifications, which we've used in the past also. That's you.
As we continue our tennis match, district meetings. So we are preparing to host meetings in each commissioner district, and we'd like to invite each of you, if you are available to attend, those meetings to discuss, again, the commercial, industrial, and employment campus districts. And since these are just the text amendments, it's a lot of written out text, so it's not very engaging. So what we are going to do is try to put those text into a visual representation by the utilization of pictures and graphics, and frankly, Lego models to show what bulk requirements are. So that way the citizens understand what it is, and the property owners understand what we are putting forward and how it can affect them, and just to have them get a better understanding of what the zoning code is and how it works on the ground. So I think having those visual representations would be very helpful, because we're not at the map portion itself yet. This is just, again, that book that we have, that text document of how land use is regulated in Carroll County. So we are we have some holds on some dates for our senior centers within the North Carroll Senior Center, Tawnytown Senior Center, Mount Airy Senior Center, South Carroll Senior Center, and then here in 003 for the county office building. So we are going to be finalizing those dates. Again, we wanted to wait for your concurrence before we moved forward on anything official, but that's the game plan that we have laid out thus far to be able to have the public involved in this process now that we have solid text written that have been vetted not only through many departments in Carroll County that work with this code regularly, but as well as experts in the field through the use of our focus group that we've received comments back from that we've been working with for the last several months as well. So now it's time to bring it out to the general public for their consideration and comments as well.
Excellent. That's it. Thank you.
It's incredibly.
So, back up to that last slide you just closed.
This one?
This chart, yes. Mm-hmm. I have a question on the concept, residential concept team. What comprises the residential concept team and the focus groups for residential rezoning?
We have not selected the focus group for that particular district yet. We've been focused on the commercial and industrial, so that'll be our next effort. And for the concept team, we envision it'll be very similar to who we have now, which is the county attorney's office, land and resource management, zoning administrator, development review, planning.
Did you see that was the concept, that last group, is that the focus or the
concept? That was concept team. The county staff that are working to develop the draft. The focus group are the technical experts in the field, and you know that could be a good opportunity to have some citizens that are familiar with this type of effort be part of the focus group, who we send materials to after, given the technical nature of the zoning code. It makes sense to have it developed by the experts in the county who do utilize this information. Then we forward it to a focus group who are basically technical experts in their field with regards to this. So I could envision for the residential that we would work with land developers, realtors again. And then again, if there's some citizen groups like the Finksburg citizens group that we've been working with, they would be a good group to vet it through from a citizen's perspective. The Freedom group, I'm not sure how active they are, but if there are some active citizens that would want to review to be a part of this focus group, we'd be happy to work with them on this, as well as others throughout the county to cover all the districts as well.
I personally would want to see some citizens groups given the opportunity to participate as focus groups.
And we'd be happy to work with them at that level.
Any other questions or comments?
Very good.
Now, incredibly impressive.
Yeah.
Kudos to all of you that put this together.
Thank you. We've been working really hard. And I couldn't have done any of this without all the support from my colleagues in the county. Everyone's been really wonderful. And really, it's it's actually been really exciting and fun to see this creative effort come to fruition and see this kind of flesh out in reality.
I like the high tech and low tech combining to get the word out, so everyone should hear about this. That's really good.
Can we get copies of this ahead of time to preview? No?
Hold on, copies of what?
I mean, of what you're intending to present at these events.
Yes, I actually have a document I've prepared, so I'll send up chapter one, part one to you with all of this information. So you'll have a one-stop shopping with all the materials now mm-hmm. that we're kind of finalizing them of what will be posted on the website, the postcard, et cetera.
We can share the postcard with you yep. today.
Yeah, but I just want to Excellent. Understand what's going to be there before we get there and blindsided.
You mean like sure. for the meetings?
For the meetings,
Oh,
yes.
yeah, oh, yeah.
Yeah, oh, yeah.
Yeah,
yeah.
Stay tuned. We're still working on
the information
going
to be presented to people beforehand. Yep.
I really like the postcard idea. I mean, because people are saying how they didn't know, but now it's been mailed to your house. So, and plus it has that, I don't know what the little code is that you can take the camera and so forth.
You'll,
really
you'll still have somebody.
Well, there'll still be some, but yeah. I mean, what else can we do? I mean, it's everywhere now.
Pick up the rock so they can come out from there anytime.
And again, I think working with our partners, the libraries and the senior centers, they have technology there. They have people that can assist in utilizing that technology. So if someone is interested, they know they can go here. They can go to their local centers to utilize the technology that's there to be able to participate from that level as well. So even if they don't have it in their homes, there are so many avenues right. in the county for them to be able to utilize. Yeah. That. And again, this is just a very tentative timeline. This is if everything runs smoothly, no glitches, no
right.
major snow events, that we are utilizing this time frame as our guide to continue to move this effort forward.
Very good.
All right.
Yep. Excellent job.
Thank you very much. Okay. All right. Item four then would be Planning Zoning Commission questions. I guess Linda's still up.
I'm still here. Can't get rid of me yet. So the last item before you today, as you all have directed, is to put any Freedom questions on your agenda after a Planning Commission meeting where Freedom was the topic of discussion. Planning Commission met on Tuesday to talk about several items with regards to the Freedom Plan. They have no questions for the board, but if there's anything you would like me to relay back to the Planning Commission for their next meeting on January 3rd, I'd be happy to do so.
Do you have any sense of where we are from time frame or what you know?
I can't say time frame, but I can tell you where they are. So the vision statement I think is coming down its final stretch. I get the sense that at the January 3rd meeting they'll be ready to take action with regard to a vision statement revisions. The land use definitions I think are very close to being fully defined from their perspective to be able to reincorporate those back into the plan. And then the last item that we haven't really discussed was the actual map itself. So that those will be for future agenda items, is to talk again and address the land use map and the table of changes that were proposed mm-hmm. from the 2001 to the most recent plan. So that's the last hurdle. And I can't say to how many meetings that will take, but I'll assure you it'll be on every agenda until the items are done.
So they're getting pretty far along, say, by the first quarter. I mean, it sounds like they're...
I'm very hopeful and optimistic. The Planning Commission is motivated to make the additional changes that have been requested and forwarded up to the board as soon as they can.
Excellent.
So we can focus on this effort, right. The comprehensive rezoning effort.
Well, that's good. No, I think that's...
Could you take a minute and just tell us, I was in and out yesterday, or Tuesday, I guess it was, what's going on with PUDs, changes to PUDs, and with what you're looking at, trying to accomplish there?
So the planned unit development, or PUD, is a provision within our current code for a mixed unit type of development. Mm-hmm. And the current one that we have on the books has rarely been utilized in the county. So in order to give some flexibility to our 10,000, our 7,500, and Mary, correct me if I'm wrong, was our 20,000 included in the PUD?
It is not currently, but it's on the table. They're discussing it now.
Okay, to to look at repealing the current PUD that we have in the county code. It just because, again, it's just not utilized. It doesn't make a lot of sense to continue to have it there. And to replace that with the PUD would be the recommendation of the Planning Commission with the adoption of the Freedom Plan, to do that as you consider your code revisions, to have a PUD ordinance that would be utilized in the R20, R10, and R7500 at varying levels, you know, a lower intensity in the R20,000, and then with increasing increments of perhaps mixes of housing types in the R10,000 and R7500. So Planning Commission is still discussing that. There's like six or seven scenarios on the table that they wanted us to bring back. So that's a whole discussion in and of itself, that once they are at a comfort level and we know what direction they're moving in, we can bring back to you.
But right now, PUDs are permitted in high-density residential, correct?
Well, they're permitted in R7500 and R10,000.
Which is considered high-density by Carroll County standards. What I thought I heard you say was that there would now be changes that might allow PUDs in medium density, R20,000.
That has been part of the discussion.
If that's the case, that would reopen R20,000 back up for something other than single-family homes, right? Apartments?
That's what they're discussing in a limited way.
Just want the board to know that. That's a fundamental, epic shift from where we've been for the last 50 years.
Is this related to the Freedom Plan or just in general?
So, again, the land use definitions that we move forward with the Freedom Plan would also be the ones that we'd be utilizing for the comprehensive rezoning, because they're really not fundamentally different than what was developed for the master plan. So, again, these would be the overarching guidelines. The PUD is not a land use definition, but it's something that Planning Commission wanted to discuss as part of the land use definitions to see if it would make sense to fit a PUD in at the residential medium and residential high land use definitions. It's just so when they have their definition, if the intent was to have the PUD utilized, it would be in the land use, so that way when plans are adopted, again, one of the things that have been discussed is these land use definitions are so vague. We're not sure how it'll work out on the ground. This was a way to give more details of how this would flesh out in zoning from the land use definitions.
Yeah, okay.
All right, any other questions?
Great, all right, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Happy holidays.
I got you. All right, item five, request to approve a grant award FY 2018 Edward J. Byrne Memorial Justice Assistance Grant for Carroll County State's Attorney's Office.
Gentlemen, I have to head out.
So I'm going to talk about
see
that.
See you.
Commissioner Howard.
Get on the agenda ASAP.
We're going to move now.
We got big problems.
Good morning, Commissioners.
Good morning.
We are here before you this morning to seek approval to accept the FY 2018 BJAG Grant Award for the State's Attorney's Office. The Board of Commissioners approved to submit the BJAG application on May 25th of this year. The primary purpose of the BJAG grant is to improve sentencing and correction policies, reduce crime in communities, provide public safety, protect victims, remove guns from violent offenders, track DNA, train local law enforcement, and provide state-of-the-art technology to law enforcement. We received $47,435 as an award. These awarded funds will fully support the requested 25-hour per week contractual drug court prosecutor position in the state's attorney's office. Should you have any questions, Ned Coyne from the state's attorney's office is here today to address those. Thank you.
Do you have any questions?
What's this individual responsible for? What are they going to do? What are their job responsibilities, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera?
Currently, we have a prosecutor who's a full-time prosecutor that segments time for drug court. It's been that way since 2007. Drug court's capacity has gone up 50% the last, I think, 2 years, because the drug court got a grant from the Office of Problem Solving Courts that added a case manager and I think partially funded a public defender. We did not get funding. We've never received funding from the Office of Problem Solving Court. We tried to absorb the responsibilities, but with this increased capacity, we needed additional resources. Office of Problem Solving Court didn't give us resources, so we got this grant to help us. So that's the primary goal. We also, when Brian came into office, we create a diversion program for people at the lower end. Drug court handles people that are facing serious incarceration. At the lower end, we have an early intervention program that allows people with minor theft or drug histories, nonviolent offenders who are using opiates, to get intense treatment. So what we do is we have them supervised by pretrial services where they get tested at least once a week. They admit to a crime, we postpone their sentencing. If they do well over that intense treatment over a year, we revisit their criminal guilty finding and they get we essentially dismiss it and they get the case expunged. So it's somebody who normally, if they got regular probation, would not get intense supervision because they're low risk and the resources don't go to low risk, they go to high risk. Because with the Justice Reinvestment Act, a lot of people with higher risk are being pushed back into the communities. So the resources for supervision through parole and probation is towards those folks, not your minor shoplifter or person in minor drug possession.
Okay. So it's an earlier intervention that we've been doing in the past, so we can get some of these people on the right track before they're so far down the road.
Absolutely. So we're preventing future criminals and we're preventing deaths from drug overdoses. Because unfortunately, it's not the stereotypical thing that somebody's been using heroin for decades and they pass away. We're finding people in their 20s passing away, early heroin or opiate users are passing away because it is such a gamble when someone goes out on the street and purchases heroin, which could be mixed with fentanyl, right. Carfentanil, you name it, that is so risky. And there's no rhyme or reason who survives and who doesn't. We're going to try to expand capacity in that as well. Currently, we have about 19 or 20 in our early intervention program. We think we can expand that as well. So we intend to keep this person very busy with these responsibilities.
So in order to get an early intervention program, you have to plead guilty to a crime?
You do plead guilty to a crime, and it's usually a misdemeanor crime. And so the carrot at the end of there is that they get their case dismissed and automatic expungement. If it's somebody who wouldn't have been facing incarceration anyway, they plead guilty or be found guilty after a trial and get traditional probation. And then if it's a probation before judgment, it could take some time to expunge it. If it's a conviction, it could take 10 years to expunge it under the new law.
And so during this program, they're going to get drug tested weekly or something?
At least weekly. Well. Sometimes I just got an email while I was waiting that we have somebody. The neat thing is that once somebody messes up, we get them back to court immediately. Similar to the drug court concept, there's immediate consequences. So it's not to necessarily punish someone, but it's to get them help so they don't pass away or commit more serious crimes. Because what we're trying to prevent is to save lives, and we're trying to prevent someone who takes a drug addiction from minor thefts, nonviolent, to robbing convenience stores and other more desperate crimes, which endangers public safety in the community.
Is this only for opioids or any type of drug abuse?
It can be any type of drug, but because we're in triage mode, we're focusing on opiates because other drugs are not as dangerous immediately to end someone's life with what we're facing with the opiate crisis.
Right. Any other questions?
Any? What's the parameters surrounding what job description for this individual? I mean, is it someone that has to be trained in something or had?
No, we're going to try to hire experienced prosecutor. It's a senior level prosecutor. It's part time, so we're going to try to find someone who has the ability to kind of conform their schedule to this. Drug courts meet every other Friday for court, and then right. Staffings are on Thursday. Early intervention is kind of a flowing thing where you're constantly looking at dockets to see who would be appropriate and fielding questions. So we're going to try to get an experience, not an entry-level person, because we want someone who's
right.
experienced with the criminal justice system that kind of knows how things would go and kind of has a better sense of who would be appropriate for both drug court and early intervention.
Okay.
All right.
Okay.
Yes. I'll move the Board of Commissioners accept the FY18 Ed Byrne Memorial Justice Assistance Grant Award.
Second.
All right, motion and second. Any other discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank
Have
you.
A good holidays.
Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioners.
Okay, move on to item six, exercise to purchase an easement on the Virginia O. Lampert property. Should have Tom Vilvis, is it coming up? No. J.P. Smith, Deb Bowers. Thanks.
Good morning, Commissioners.
Good morning.
Morning. We're here this morning to bring you one of the last two remaining from the FY17 batch of farmland preservation applicants. The Lampert property is out on Uniontown Road. And It's in District 1. It's 164 acres, so it's one of the larger farms from our FY17 application cycle. Lot rights being retired is actually 13. That's a mistake there. The cost will be $832,324.78, which comes out to about $5,100 per acre. This is a view of the Lambert property. The front's on Uniontown Road, as you can see, and the whole farm is in hay. It's a really beautiful property. It's been very well kept. Here's as how it lays. It's 2.5 miles from the Westminster growth boundary and very close to Uniontown, as you can see. It really is going to help fill a gap there where we have a lot of preserve farms in that area. This property has a lot of linear feet of stream, and we will be, of course, requiring protection of that stream with a 50-foot buffer, even with the hay there, and if the fields are ever changed into row crops, it will expand out to 100 feet. The Lamberts have agreed to this, and they really care about their streams. It's a, like I say, it's a really beautiful property. It is quite visible from Uniontown Road.
When you say there's a 50-foot buffer from the stream, what does that mean? That they can't do anything within 50 feet? Or?
They can't put fertilizers there. They can't graze cattle within 50 feet of that stream. So it protects the stream.
Well, right now it's not row cropped.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of flat area in the bottom there next to the stream, and we felt like if the management of the property was changed with the hills in the background, that we would need more protection on the stream.
Wow, that's a lot.
They agreed to this, right?
Better protection, yes.
Okay. That's a lot, I think, to even if it does change in the future. What's mandatory by mouth?
They will be able to take hay from that, so it's not completely taken out of production. And the Lamberts have been growing hay here for quite a while. So.
Yeah, but if they change their production methods, say 30 years down the road, you're going to require a 100-foot buffer.
Another grass. It would be grass.
Is that a state requirement on this?
No. No, it's not.
Where did that come from?
No, it's something. It's just something that we worked out through the process of negotiation with the landowners.
They did not want to plant trees, and we do consider that a better protection. So we have converted how we're doing buffers. We're allowing grass buffers now, and it really made sense on this property, as it's been in grass for quite a while. So rather than plant trees, we agreed to a wider buffer, grass buffer.
How many acres does this entail throughout this property that you're going to require, if it would change 100 feet?
Not sure we measured that in acres.
That area, some part of that area would still be able to be taken off of it. We were just trying to avoid the fact that, you know, when you're planting crops along a forested buffer, you lose the first couple, you know, planter widths of corn or anything like that. So that's why we widened it and we made it a strip that could, some amount of it could be harvested in hay.
The Lamberts didn't want to plant trees. Part of it was, well, most of it was for the aesthetics of it. She did not want to have trees growing between their house and the road.
She didn't want to hide the
stream from the, and it, like I say, it's a beautiful property, so.
I just think 100 acres is excessive for future use. It's
You mean 100 feet?
100 feet.
100 feet.
100 feet, I mean, for future uses.
And the alternative is planting trees.
And planting trees or even a 50-foot buffer, so wide buffer area, I mean, for a lot of areas. So.
But it's only if they change their use, and they've agreed to.
It's their choice. I understand that, but I think from the county's point of view, that's excessive.
I agree, Dick. I agree with you 100%. 50 feet is plenty.
There's been plenty of buffers in the past, depending on the slope of the property right next to the stream, that have been, you know, required to be wider. And this practice is NRCS approved. So we're using all, you know, approved type buffers, you know, on these people's farms.
I have a question. I see we have Tom Devilbus in the audience. Tom, would you have the microphone a second?
Should have left when you
were discussing this. We were discussing this issue on other properties in Western County. Wasn't there some data that showed once we got beyond 60 feet that the marginal rate of return in terms of improvement from the buffer was de minimis? There was a study. I think you showed it to me. Was it 60 feet?
Well, Commissioner, I'm going to tell you right now, I can't recall the study. Not sure I can actually quote numbers and all. And I think the buffer width, they vary depending on the purpose. I would say in this case, maybe using the term buffer is not necessarily the most appropriate, because that additional 50 feet that's being put on there, that can still be hayed and used for production. What it's saying is basically, I think, Deb and JP, you can correct me, they do not want any type of row crops done in that extra 50 foot. So it's almost like you're creating a little extra protection there from the row crops should they ever occur on that farm again. So I don't, when you say it's a buffer, yes, but that buffer can be utilized for agricultural purposes, which is hayage.
But you're 200 feet wide now, each side of the stream.
That's correct.
Yeah, so I mean, this is
100 on each side.
100 on each side, but
yes,
this is 200 foot buffer.
Right. But again, I don't think it, normally when people think of buffers, they think of undisturbed buffers and that you're not going to be able to do anything with them. And that's not the case that this is proposing here. In fact, correct me if I'm wrong, can they do the hayage in the 50 foot adjacent to the stream?
Yes.
Yes, up and but they still, through state regulations, can't spread fertilizer within 35 feet.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So they're still restricted, you know, by other laws.
Exactly. So we're not taking this out of production. That additional 50 foot is not being taken out of production. So.
But you limit what they can do. It has to be in hay.
There are limits in most everything we do, Commissioner.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. I'm just.
Do you use hay, Mr. Weaver?
Okay.
The thing is, we are paying for this use, and the easement pays not just to remove the development potential, to keep the farm and agricultural use only, and it is also paying for conservation practices, and I think it's you know, a worthwhile purchase for that.
Okay. Any other questions?
No.
Do we have a motion?
I'll move that we exercise the option to purchase the easement on the Virginia Lambert property.
We need a second.
You second it?
Do we need a second? We need a second, is what I'm saying.
Yeah, you need one.
They agreed to this. I will second it, but I am not going to be supportive of this in the future for properties, I don't think. So.
We rarely do a buffer this wide, but we do negotiate out all of our buffers.
Mm-hmm.
It just depends on the particular property and the slope of the land and how the property is used.
So I want to just add to what Commissioner Weaver said. I'll support this, but I want to make it clear that this vote does not set a precedent of what we expect to see for buffers in the future. If the property owner in this case had no heartburn with it, that's fine, but I would also make it clear to the public that we're not accepting this as the norm for future buffers.
No, we don't have a standard width. We negotiate all of our buffers, except we do not want to go lower than 50 feet.
Yeah, I think the very fact that we've already discussed that this is a extenuating circumstances on this property leads to what you're saying. So I got no issue with it. I agree that it, but in this particular case, I'm good with it, which is why I want the motion.
Just making it clear for the record, because
right,
I don't want anybody coming back a year from now saying, well, Commissioner Rutter, you supported 100-foot barbers
right,
before, you're a hypocrite.
I know, right.
No, we're making it clear this is an extenuating exception.
Yep.
Okay.
All right, we have a motion and a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Thank you, Commissioners.
No, thank
you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks for your work on that, too. That is a good farm. Thank you. It's
thank
a good
you.
Area out there.
Yeah, but.
Okay, next item is a budget transfer from John Ticket Road. Who do we have for that? Donnell Davis, Debbie Butler. I don't see Jeff anywhere.
Good morning.
Good morning.
One of these days, I'm going to roll the whole way back. Cheers. good morning.
We're
here this morning to request your approval on a budget transfer from the Pavement Management 16 project to Gravel Roads. This item was last brought to the board on September 14th. At that time, the board had approved a transfer for Baltimore Gas and Electric relocation. Since then, we've received a cost estimate from Verizon in the amount of $13,640. In order to move forward with a purchase order and have Verizon be ready to start moving their utilities once BG&E is complete, we need to have a budget transfer approved. So that's the reason we're here today, and the funds are available in FY16 pavement management. And can answer any questions that you have.
They didn't see this coming earlier in September?
It's interesting. In September, we had cost estimates for Verizon.
Yeah.
Their letter, their estimate was dated the 14th. So timing is everything.
Verizon is, they have separate, they have underground cables or something? Or
yes.
So they have underground cable that has to move.
Yes.
Okay.
And they share BG&E poles.
Right.
Right now, BG&E has relocated their poles. They are planning to start their underground relocation very shortly.
Okay.
Once they're done, then Verizon can move in.
All right.
And we've been in constant communication. They're like a lot of people. They're very busy as well, and we're trying to, you know, move this forward as quickly as we can.
So if we move the poles and everything, they're going to need the poles to put their materials on, correct?
I'm sorry, what was that?
They're going to need the poles to put their utilities on, or the underground areas, right?
Theirs is all underground.
Oh, underground, okay. So they're going to have to. All right. Oh.
Any other questions?
Yeah, Ted's back there.
Oh, sorry, Ted.
On the question about anticipating this, I just wanted to remind the commissioners this was not unanticipated. The commissioners asked Public Works to come back when they had an actual number. You said you didn't want to put money in that was going to be in the ballpark. And in fact, they're going to have to come back one more time yet on this project because you asked them to do it that way.
I remember that. Yep.
Okay.
Good point.
Thanks, Ted. Okay, any other questions?
So just as a point of clarification, I probably asked this the last time. We're paying for Verizon to move their utilities, is that correct? When
yes.
we do a road project, they're not responsible for the cost, we are.
It depends on the utility. BG&E, if they had prior rights to be there, then we are responsible for that. If they don't, you know, we cost share with them. Verizon, you know, a lot of their lines and poles were put in years ago on a handshake, you know, so that there's not the documentation there to show who is there first.
I'm sure John Pickett Road was there first.
Probably.
Just saying.
Totally agree.
Yeah, that's why I'm a little bit challenged by this, because just because we're making improvements to the area doesn't mean we have to pay for the utilities to do their thing. They should be paying because we're making the improvements. I'm just a little troubled by paying them for something that is ultimately their responsibility.
We can certainly ask questions of them as to their philosophies.
Yeah, I don't, you know. I mean, albeit it's not a huge amount. However, you know, every $13,000 adds up to, you know, and I've, don't start with me about gravel roads, because we could be here all day and talk about those. I could put that towards something else. You know what I mean? Deb?
So what do you need? What do you need from us today, Deb? What do you need from us today on this?
Your approval to have a budget transfer completed.
In what amount?
$13,640.
Okay. Well, I move that the Board of Commissioners approve the transfer amount of $13,640 for to cover the cost of these additional utility expenses.
We have a motion. Do we have a second?
I'll second it.
Second, all right. Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
I'm opposed because I, and this is just a message, in the future I think we should be negotiating with the utilities. It should be their responsibility when it comes to costs and not ours. Even though it's our project, I think they should be bearing the burden of the cost.
Well, actually, let me ask a legal question. They have an easement right now, don't they, to run their lines? Do they have an easement?
They may or may
I
not.
I don't believe so.
They probably don't.
See, if they had an easement.
Not there.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
I know where you're going.
BG&E does do that a lot, where they will obtain an easement from a property owner if it's not in a right-of-way.
As something's needed, but you don't obtain that easement until you need to, need to have it.
Yeah.
And I agree with you, Commissioner Wance. This is it seems like we shouldn't be paying for everything. We want to update things. They understand it's coming.
I just, you know, utilities have big pockets. We don't necessarily have a big pocket. So I'm just, you know, I don't want to set a precedence here. Whenever we do an improvement project on a road, that it's going to be, well, you know, you're going to pay for everything. It's not, you know, I just.
Well, when we have documentation, we don't have to pay for everything, correct? But what you said, we don't have documentation of what went first and all those other
prior rights.
Right, prior rights. But if we have documentation on that, then we kind of work out an agreement with them.
Yeah.
But in this particular project, we do not have the documentation.
Each utility handles it differently.
Yeah.
How close to the road is this line?
I didn't mean to mention
it. Ditch line. I mean, it's right alongside.
So we can't widen the road or improve with that utility in there?
It has to be moved.
Pave over it, and then it's our problem.
Well, could become our problem if something goes wrong, and then they have to
I understand. I just
and I don't want to dwell on this. Does Verizon have a liaison like we have with BGE? Is there someone you reach out to?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay.
Yes.
Okay. And I know you did your due diligence with this. I'm not. This is not anything against you guys, because I know the great work that you do, but. Just moving forward, I sure would like to see the utilities pick up the cost on these projects.
I agree. I would be
see what you can do. See what you can do.
Thank you.
All right, thank you guys.
You. Okay, our next item is the Board of County Commissioners sitting as the Board of Health. So Ed Singer coming forward.
So I'm just getting over a cold, Ed. Can I still sit as the Board of Health? I don't think, is there a technicality there or anything?
I don't know. And I'll leave that up to Commissioner Frazier. It's his. If you give him your germs, Matt, we're going to have everybody come up individually because we've got a number of people to present.
So we had a stethoscope.
So we need a motion, right?
What's that?
No, we got a stethoscope for this.
You need to make a motion to sit as the Board of Health.
That's why I asked the question, you know. So there's there.
All right. Mr. Wance can't
vote. Actually, Weaver's sicker than I am.
We need a motion to sit as the Board of Health.
I'm getting better.
Board of Commissioners, I guess what we're reconvening here as the Board of Health?
Yeah. All right.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Even Wance voted for that.
Thank you. I don't even have to prompt you guys anymore. We're getting used to this.
Good.
So it is to meet our requirement to have two annual Board of Health meetings in state law. And I want to first take the opportunity to introduce a few staff that I have here. I have Teresa Moyer, who's back in the day, Larry had an administrative assistant, Susie Kyler, who used to come and take notes for the Board of Health. We're technically supposed to do that, and we haven't been complying very well with that. So Teresa's supporting the entire Bureau of Administration. So she does some work with me and Dr. Taylor and everybody in our administration bureau to provide us support and contracting work for us. So we kind of combined a number of positions together to get Teresa to fill some important roles for us. So this is Teresa back here in the back. Of course, I think you guys have met Dr. Taylor, know Dr. Taylor. I have Cindy Bosley, my nursing director, here. Lee Broderick, my environmental health director. I'm going to introduce Maggie Koontz, who is our health planner. She's going to do, she's got a speaking role today, so you don't have to listen to me for a long time. And I have Veronica Dietz, who is our crisis services director. So I'm going to leave most of the speaking to my staff and let them talk about some things that they're working on. I did want to take this opportunity to thank the Board of Commissioners for their support on our opioid leadership team and the other initiatives that we've had. Staff have been great. Your emergency response folks, emergency management folks have had to have a lot of involvement in this because of what the state's put on them, and the whole staff down there have been great. It's been wonderful working with Citizen Services as we continue to focus on this opioid epidemic and the things that are coming down from the state level to work cooperatively on that. I also appreciate Commissioner Wentz. Noticed you were at the community health needs assessment. That's you know, it's very unique to Carroll County that we're working off the same needs assessment with the hospital as opposed to doing our own things. And I've seen some of the initial information that's come back, and I don't know if you participated, you probably got that too. I'm going to let the partnership make that public, but it's great that we're working on this together, because I think a lot of things that are going to fall out in the priorities, some of the things we're already working on, so we can kind of coordinate with the hospital and the partnership to figure out who has which pieces of the puzzles and what we can do to make improvements in those areas that are identified as priorities for our community. So really appreciate your focus and help with that and supporting the partnership and the needs assessment that the hospital and we both need to work off of.
Yeah, I was impressed with the makeup of the room, Ed. There were folks there from all walks of life in Carroll, so not just healthcare providers. There were a lot of citizens there that have a stake in this too. So kudos to those that put it together. And you know, I did get there a little bit late, but I am getting the gist of all the information they're sending me, all that. So nicely done on that too.
Honestly, the partnership was in existence before I became the health officer. It's something that's unique to Carroll County right now, and there are other health officers that are trying to duplicate it, because it makes sense that we pull our resources together with the hospital, and it saves both of us money and resources to be able to collaborate as opposed to work in our silos. So it's we're fortunate to have the wave of the future before the future got here. So I guess I just want to go on to say that our when I became health officer, I talked to you guys about transitioning from our clinical focus to focusing on the population of the county from a public health focus. And as we've had some of our clinicians retiring and through attrition, we've changed our focus in the staff that we've replaced them with. As I mentioned, Maggie Koontz, our health planner, she's here today, and she's going to give you a little briefing about some of the things that she's working on. We've also replaced a nurse with an epidemiologist, and she'll be starting in January. And you know, that type of position to take a look at things from a broad perspective rather than a clinical role. So we're changing our staffing patterns to meet where I told you the direction was that we were going to take the health department when I came on board as the health officer. We'll still need to provide some safety net clinical services in our programs, but those are scaled down and pushed out into the community. I mean, there are a lot of things that clinically over the years that we're no longer providing. The last thing that I want to mention before I turn it over to some other folks to say a few things is we're working on some statistical data about disease trends that we plan to present in the spring. We'll have our epidemiologist here and whatnot, but at this point I'm going to go ahead and turn it over to Dr. Taylor. One other thing, and I almost missed my note here on this. I'd love to hear from you guys if there are things that you want to talk about from the health department's perspective, anything that you'd like to talk about as a Board of Health or even as a Board of Commissioners. that you'd like us to come and talk to you about. We can prepare whatever you want to see presented. I just think that having that two-way communication has worked real well for me on the opioid senior leadership team, asking people, hey, what do you want to see on the agenda? So if you guys have ideas of things that you want to know what's going on over at the health department or you have questions about, we'd be glad to come and present those in open session so that we can have that open dialogue. At this point, Dr. Taylor's going to say a few brief words about the flu, and then we'll get into the three agenda items that we have.
Before you get to that, since you mentioned epidemiologists three times, can you refresh my memory of what that actually is?
So what the epidemiologist does is they take a look at disease patterns. They're, from a statistical standpoint, the rates of disease and where the disease is happening and the demographics, and try to figure out, basically from a statistical standpoint, where we should be focusing our resources to try to improve our efforts to prevent the spread of disease. I think that, is that a good way to describe it, Henry?
Right on target.
Okay.
Thank you.
So I'll turn it over to Dr. Taylor, and he's got a few words to say about flu, and then we'll get our other folks up here and get you guys off to lunch.
And Commissioner Wentz, you actually may be, I know you're a leader, but the flu is starting, so you may be leading the community in terms of starting the flu epidemic.
I had my shot, Doc. I'm good.
You got your shot.
It's a simple common cold, okay?
Okay.
It's called a placebo shot.
I had all my shots. Yeah, I knew you were going to bring that up. I had all my shots.
The rabies shot up today.
That's not appropriate for me to say.
Let's just throw it out there.
I still don't want to get
it. Is he your bulldog? Is that the... I don't know. You might want to check the Humane Society, make sure he's got his license as well.
Thanks for bringing that up. I certainly do appreciate that. Good way to start, okay?
That's great. Perhaps you could bark for us.
And the two of you.
I do a lot of barking.
That would be Commissioner Howard, excuse me. I withdraw the comment.
This conversation's made the first two points for me, which is that the epidemic officially is minimal and regionally sporadic in the state, which means by looking at the trends, and an epidemiologist will help us do this better, but within the next 1 to 2 weeks, I think we're going to start seeing flu spreading in the community. That, if doing the math isn't complicated, that'll be during the holidays when kids are out of school, so that often will limit the spread of an epidemic to not have everybody in the same place. The bad news is that you'll actually probably, hopefully, be linking with other people and crossing all sorts of social networks, which will give the flu virus a lot of opportunity to spread. So first message is flu's coming down the pike. Second message is if you haven't gotten your shot, it's not too late. The shot will take effect within 1 to 2 weeks and get you some immunity in time for when we expect it to be coming through the community. If you are at a holiday gathering, hand washing is always, you know, folks should have that pretty well drummed into their head. But another thing people don't realize is when you cough and sneeze, usually the droplets that are carrying the virus fall down and precipitate out within 3 feet. So maintaining social distance, and all sorts of jokes can come from that, but maintaining social distance of 3 feet from people who are potentially contagious is not a bad idea and is a public health recommendation. If you are one of the people who might get serious complications, the flu virus this year, looking at in the southern hemisphere where they have their flu epidemic in our summertime, looking in Australia in particular, the viral strain they had seems to be pretty well sensitive to the various antivirals. We don't want to overuse them because we can breed resistance, but this is a year when we're thinking that those people who have illnesses and need to have an extra level of protection should really get their antivirals in a timely manner. If you don't start them right away, it's not going to help once you really come down with the flu and are suffering the symptoms. So
they tell us we should or we shouldn't buy non-refundable New Year's Eve tickets.
Yeah, that's right. You need to, or maybe wear a mask. You know, you could go out there in public. It's probably more socially acceptable. The flu, we were a little concerned from the Australian experience that they were finding the flu shot was only about 10% effective against what we think is the main strain circulating. A more recent report based on early U.S. data says it's up towards where it usually is in the 40% range. So even a little bit of protection, even that 10%, does help. So main message is get your flu shot.
Okay. Thank you, Henry. Now, you guys have any questions before Veronica? You're next on our hit list. So, Veronica's our director of crisis services, and one of the things that's come out of the efforts of the governor and the opioid operation command center is, you know, we as a leadership team, as a leadership group, identified with all of our community partners a need for. We've known we've had this need for a while for mobile crisis services. So Veronica's going to tell you about our crisis services overall, and then how this new service that we've contracted for is going to come into play. Veronica?
So good morning, commissioners.
Good morning.
In terms of crisis response and crisis services, at present, the Carroll County Health Department does collaborate with local law enforcement. And again, thank you to Commissioner Wance, who came out to our fourth graduation of our CIT trained officers. At present, we have about 45 trained CIT officers in multiple municipalities, the sheriff's office, as well as the detention center. And those folks are trained to manage behavioral health emergencies in the community. So what they're doing is kind of doing a little bit of bridging stopgap services for folks who are experiencing behavioral health crises, overdoses, mental health crises. They are completing referrals, linking them to the health department, who then we go on to link them in the community to help get stable. Additionally, we are still running what's called the urgent care program. So in collaboration with Access Carroll and a clinician there who is working 20 hours a week to provide urgent mental health treatment to folks who are experiencing, again, a mental health crisis. So someone who is in need of medications or linking with ongoing mental health services can make an appointment at Access Carroll with our urgent care therapist, who will see them, provide a full psychosocial evaluation, and then do some linking with doctors, nurse practitioners at Access Carroll for medications, as long as it's, you know, something that is within the wheelhouse of Access Carroll, because there are some parameters there, and then link them for ongoing services, and then follow them for 90 days to ensure that they are linked appropriately. So that's what we have at present in terms of crisis services. Moving forward, we did put an RFP out, which closed in September, and as of, I guess, November, December, the affiliated Sante Group did accept the bid, and they will be doing a startup. April 1st is their anticipated startup for a mobile crisis unit. What they are hoping to do is then to respond in real time between the hours of 8 a.m. and 12 p.m. To behavioral health crises in the community. Again, substance use related issues as well as mental health related issues.
And we looked at those times statistically to see when it would, I'm sorry, I don't know if you were going to cover that. But we looked at those times statistically to see when the greatest need was. And I was actually surprised at the overnight hours. I guess eventually everybody falls asleep. So the overnight hours weren't as important to cover as it was to cover the daytime hours. Because originally I was thinking we would probably, since we only had enough resources to cover that period of time, that we might be covering from like 4 p.m. until like 4, 5, 6 a.m. or something like that. But because there are more services available during the day, but I think the statistics from the hospital and other places showed that the real need was really during the daytime hours and into the evening, and the overnight hours weren't as important. So there is an on-call component to it, and if there is a major crisis and they need the support, that affiliated Sante would be available for certain types of emergencies. But you know, the actual coverage is not quite 24 at this point, but I think we're moving in the right direction. So is there anything else that you wanted to add? Because I wanted to make sure we got that piece in there.
Yeah, and, I mean, I don't know if there are any other questions, but, you know, again, we are going to be monitoring that program. The hope is that they will see, anticipating a minimum of 2 calls each day to help manage. They can be dispatched along with law enforcement, so in collaboration with our CIT officers, or they can be dispatched if it's, you know, a community call. So they're going to triage those calls, determine, you know, what's most imminent, what's most urgent, and then respond in kind. The other component of our RFP did look at crisis stabilization services. So they have the mobile crisis, which responds, mitigates the crisis, but the crisis stabilization services allow for up to two visits to be sure that the original crisis is managed so that the folks don't respond and then 2 or 3 days later we find that they're in crisis again. They will provide that crisis stabilization as well. So that is a component of what the affiliated Sante will do.
And another, I guess another thing that I want to point out about this contract is that, you know, affiliated Sante is not integrally involved in our community at this point. However, when I wasn't on the review committee, but I think what the review committee ultimately found was they're providing these services in other counties and they're familiar with how to do this correctly. And the other counties that are using them are happy with the services they're receiving. So part of the contract is also that they make those connections in our community and they have a presence in our community. So they'll be linking with all the other community partners, and they're going to have to become part of their requirements in their contract as they become a part of the fabric here in Carroll County amongst the collaborations that are already going on.
And interestingly, they have very similar kind of thoughts and visions. Our agency, the health department, and our county has really worked to be a no-wrong-door county so that anybody walking into any agency can get linked, even if it's not a service that they provide. Affiliated Sante has the same vision, that it's a no-wrong-door call. So even if they respond, and it's not necessarily something that mobile crisis would respond to, they're still going to respond, provide a service or a link so that that family or that individual can continue to have supports. And you know, like Ed said, they are in probably about half of the state of Maryland. We've recently met with them. Sue Doyle, our local behavioral health authority, myself and the deputy did meet and discuss with them, and they're very excited to be in our community. They're very excited to be a part of this startup. So we're really looking forward to April 1st.
So the CIT program is incredibly impressive, I got to say.
Thank you.
Where are we in this jurisdiction with numbers? Do we have a large percentage, larger than surrounding when it comes to law enforcement officers that are trained? Because, you know, that's, without putting any pun in here, that's critically important to get that first line of intervention.
Yeah.
Before, and you mentioned this about another issue, Dennis, when you can get them before they start going down the wrong path.
Yeah.
Man, that's good stuff. So,
well, you gave numbers of how many folks we
I was just curious. I mean, I think we've got...
So I think Chief Spaulding estimates that at this point we have about 20% of our local law enforcement trained in CIT. Yeah. You know, the Memphis model is that we're not looking for 100%. We're looking for a core group of people who have an interest, you know, that aren't necessarily new or fresh out of the academy.
Right.
But these are folks that can take this additional training and go out and provide this extra service. I'm incredibly just impressed with the people that we get in our CIT program.
Yeah.
They're folks who want to help. They take this information and they immediately use it. I mean, we had graduation on Friday. By Monday, I had a new CIT referral in my office from a new CIT officer.
There
so
you go.
We love our CIT program and the collaboration.
And the one thing that I guess I would add to this about how effective the program is people in the community now know what a CIT officer is, and they'll call and ask. You know, when they're calling the dispatch, they'll call and ask, hey, we know we've got this issue. Can you send a CIT officer as opposed to just send, you know, the police?
Right.
So it's good that the word's out there and people understand what this can do for them.
Very good. Thanks, Veronica. You guys
Absolutely.
Are doing a good job with that. Thank you. Very impressive.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Next is environmental health, the one that always tends to get me in trouble with the commissioners. But
And here we go.
No, well, I'm just going to briefly, I'll let Lee talk, and this may be a really brief presentation, but you guys may remember back when we had this requirement that got adopted for statewide requirements for best available technology, that I mentioned to you there was another concern about what we had that they changed in the regulations at the same time, and that was increasing the size of the on-site sewage disposal systems, I think in some cases doubling the requirements for the amount of absorption field and all that was required, and I didn't think there was a good scientific basis for that at the time. And what I believe we're doing now is taking a look at moving things back in the other direction, which I'm surprised. It's, you know, that'll be two things that the states normally you get a regulation in place and it never gets repealed, and so I'll let Lee talk to you a little bit about what this issue is and what we're looking at down the road.
At our last two directors' meetings, which are monthly down in Annapolis, the representative from MDE told us that they were going to be putting together a proposal to raise application rates, which reduces the system sizes for commercial systems, provided that they met certain wastewater quality parameters, meaning, you know, what we call biological oxygen demand and some other things, and some of that they could achieve if they put pretreatment on there, and there's different levels of pretreatment. So what they're proposing and what's going to be published in the Maryland Register on January 19th is a new application rate chart, which will be divided into three columns. The first column will be just regular domestic strength wastewater. Second one will be wastewater that's subject to a BAT system and meets certain effluent qualities. And then the other would be what's called a MBR, membrane batch reductor. I think I'm saying that correctly, but it's a higher level of treatment, and again, their effluent has to meet certain parameters, and so they anyways, they're going to be publishing that on the 19th, and the application rates in some cases will as much as more than half the system sizes that are going in today, and so make it less than half the size, and so that we think conceptually that's a good thing, as long as there's some safeguards in place to make sure that things are properly maintained and all that, because you don't want to undersize the system, not keep the treatment up, and then have it fail.
So let me just inject a question. Mm-hmm. Commissioner Frazier has proposed something that's made a lot of sense, and that's the idea of having a separate way of managing gray water. Is there any discussion as this talks about sizing these drain fields comes up, is there any discussion about offering concessions if a household were to separate out gray water and treating that separate than the generic, regular bad stuff?
Let me address that, Lee, because Tom Devilbiss and I sat on a committee on this, and it's been discussed a lot, the gray water issue and trying to separate that and recycle some of the water, and it makes sense. From our perspective, even though MDE held a committee, they made some concessions on how gray water would be treated, but they can still consider it to be sewage, and we certainly didn't feel like it went as far as it should have, and I just think that gray water issue is something that's separate from this, but I think it's something that should continue to be worked on, but that's not something that I believe is part of this at this point in time, and it's something that we got a lot of pushback on when they actually were required. I think it was legislatively required to take a look at it, but there were a lot of reasons they shot it down. I think that, you know, maybe it's a good time to take a relook at that, because I think that it is a good concept, and we shouldn't necessarily be treating gray water or whatnot the same as we are regular domestic sewage. And the other thing is there's something to be said for we've highly treated all this wastewater at our wastewater treatment plants in some cases, and finding a way to reuse that, because we're all the municipalities are struggling with being able to come up with an adequate means of disposing of their wastewater, and they don't want to allow for any pollution loads to go into the any additional pollution loads to go into the rivers and streams. And we're limited on our appropriations on the water supply side. So I think it's a good thing that should be water reuse in general is something that I think needs to be more broadly applied. And I think that Maryland's lagging in that area. So does that answer your question?
Basically what you're telling me is they've talked about it, there's no agreement, and not really. They didn't really build it
in.
Let me take another shot at this, Lee. And this is good news that they're looking at reducing the drain field side based on the extent of pretreatment. Right now, there's a requirement for two additional backup fields for any new home. Was there any discussion about reducing the number of backup fields from two down to one? If somebody agrees to voluntarily put in a more aggressive treatment method up front.
Not with this proposed legislation. I have heard some discussion about that. I don't know if that's going to go anywhere, but I know that's been mentioned. So
this is a step in the right direction for,
sure.
You know, we've got a lot of property down in Finksburg in Carroll County, and a lot of and not as much, but some property down in Taylorsville that the county has zoned commercial and industrial, and this essentially would allow for those properties to be more fully developed by reducing the land area that's required for the installation of a septic system. Mm-hmm. And I don't know, Lee, if you want to mention what my suggestion is at this point for the commissioners as far as
what action to take. We'd recommend that when this is proposed, when this is published, that you support, maybe even send a letter supporting that action.
And I don't think it's appropriate for you guys to take action at this point, but I think that once it's published in the Maryland Register and you all have a chance to take a look at it and digest what it says, we'd be willing to draft something for you if you, as a board, decide that you think this is a move by MDE in the right direction that helps support what your goals are as a county.
It would be good.
Sounds good. Yeah.
Any other questions about that? If not, I'll let Lee head back and.
Okay.
Thanks, Lee. Okay, did you want to mention? He had one other thing he wanted to mention.
I can mention that. Yeah, just real quickly, because this is pretty recent. We had applied for an FDA grant to kind of improve things with our food inspection program, and we got approved. They're going to is a grant for $16,000 to purchase some tablets that would allow us to kind of automate things out in the field a little more, be able to give people legible inspection reports, input the information more quickly, and use it better. And so so that's hopefully is something that's going to start getting implemented in the coming winter and spring, and hopefully will improve things.
That's nice.
That sounds good. Thank customer you. Service, Lee.
Yeah.
It's very important.
Well, and it's interesting you mentioned that, because that segues into a little bit about what Maggie's going to talk about.
It does.
Okay.
And I just wanted to mention, before I turn it over to Maggie, I've talked to you all before about accreditation and whatnot, and my thoughts on accreditation, and I'm still not sure that anybody sold me on needing to go all the way through the accreditation process, but we want to be ready in case funding eventually becomes tied to it. It's a lot of resources and money and all that goes into becoming accredited, and other than saying you're accredited, I don't know that you get a lot out of it. But the conclusion I did come to is the health department did not have a strategic plan, and Maggie Coons is leading our efforts in coming up with a strategic plan, and along with that piece comes something called quality improvement that you all are probably very familiar with, and that's something else that the strategic planning group and the and Maggie are working on, and I'll let her talk about what's happening with that.
Great, thanks. Good morning. And I'm sorry I tried to come up early, but I was just too excited to talk about strategic planning, so I'm glad to get my chance to talk, and you did segue well into that.
Hold on a second. Yeah. I sent over, and I don't know if we have it available, a PowerPoint. Was that able to be loaded? I don't know.
It's not critical. I don't see it. So.
You don't see it? Okay. Well, that's fine. So Maggie's got her notes, and she can just talk off of that.
I'll paint a picture for you. So as Ed said, we are not right now pursuing public health accreditation, but we are pursuing. Oh, there they are.
Oh, there it is.
We are pursuing them.
So you can have control of it.
Well, there we go.
You've got it right now, don't you?
Yeah.
Well, you can.
I'll get you started. You can go ahead and talk, and I'll get you started.
So, how do we go back? We are not planning on pursuing accreditation, but the three prerequisites for accreditation are kind of in the works as it is. So one of them is the community health needs assessment, which, as we just talked about before, the partnership has just completed, and the completed report should be available in April or so. The local health improvement plan, which is both local information and also state information, so it kind of compares counties and how we're doing compared to other counties. So those pieces are already in place, and the local health improvement plan is was most recently updated in 2016, but will be updated again this year, later on this year. But the strategic plan, as Ed said, is something that we haven't had for a while. And to me, it's a valuable piece because it's something that takes all of this other information, this local and county information, and combines it with internal information from the health department. So things like how our employees feel about our services, how our customers feel about our services, how our community feels about our services. So that's what we're in the process of doing now, is creating that plan, collecting that information, and creating that plan that will really allow us to look ahead a few years. So basically, those are the same, those accreditation requirements, prerequisites, are the same things, are also valuable tools for us. So the reason we're pursuing them is not, so we'll be set up for accreditation if we decide to pursue it, if funding becomes tied to accreditation, but also because we feel those pieces are very valuable for our planning. So as Ed mentioned, I'm leading the effort, but with a multidisciplinary committee from all of our bureaus and all levels of staffing. And the steps that we're taking, we started out by updating our mission, vision, and values. So I'm going to run those by you very quickly. And then we're collecting data, which is what we're doing right now. And then we're going to create this 5-year strategic plan to allow us to more clearly define our goals and hopefully meet the community's needs. So here's our mission. We've had a mission. This is actually very similar to our old mission, but just tweaked a little bit, shortened a little bit. Promoting community health. Educating and protecting the public, and collaborating with community partners. Those are things we've always valued, and this just spells them out a little more clearly. Doing it again. So the vision, really a vision is something I read, I thought this was cute, this should fit on a t-shirt. So if we had health department t-shirts, this would be our what we'd have on them. A safe and healthy community for all. It's what we see that we will help hopefully create in our community. And the values are principles that guide us in the way that we interact with our customers and you know what we want our staff to promote. So respect, responsiveness, excellence, professionalism, and integrity. And again, all of these things were done in collaboration with leadership, with all of our staff, and with our committee. So right now, we're in the process of collecting data, which is a very long and arduous process. We have program reports from all of our programs, so we're looking at performance measures and where they are. And then we've done a series of employee surveys, satisfaction, leadership, communication, facilities, and training. We got some great responses. Lots of employees responded. We had some really good information. Over 80% are happy to be working there and are pleased to be part of, are helping the community. And almost 80% plan to stay at the health department for at least 2 years, so we were happy to know that. But lots of items to improve. Of course, surveys always give you lots of items to improve, and we're pleased about that.
What are the other
20% doing? The other 20% do. Good question. Well, the other 20% are probably, they're probably withholding their answers until they see how we respond to some of their other comments. So we had lots of items to improve. Communication between employees and leadership, employee recognition, some security issues, training, and facilities issues. And many of those things we're working on already. We got a lot of concrete suggestions, things we were planning on doing and things we maybe weren't ready to do, but we're starting a lot of those things now to address those things and hopefully improve even our, get that number even higher. So in addition to our employee surveys, we've been doing customer surveys. We administered them through November. The response was a little bit lower than I'd hoped, but the results were very positive. 97% said they were very satisfied or satisfied with the services they received. And we administered these surveys mostly in our lobby, but also at our Access Carroll site, and also through some of our home visit services and some in the community services. So we did try to get a cross-section of consumers in that survey. Because it's so low, we may repeat this. There are also supplemental surveys going on in other programs that are program-specific that will combine with that. And then we're also going to do another survey, which I'll talk about in a second. So we were pleased with the response. Our next survey, as Ed said, he'd love to hear from you as the Board of Health to find out more about what you would like to see us be doing. And we also want to hear from you through the stakeholder survey. So in January, we'll be putting out a stakeholder survey for our community partners to assess how they feel we work with them and support other organizations, to learn more about how other organizations see our agency. So you'll be seeing this come out, as I said, in early January. It'll be a quick online survey, and we're hoping to get a really good response from our community partners. We'll also be sending out a similar...
I just wanted to chime in here and mention Commissioner Wentz, because you had mentioned the customer service piece. One of the stakeholders, we had a list of stakeholders, and one of the things that I wanted to make sure that Maggie included in is on our list is all those folks that we regulate. We want to make sure that we're getting they had an opportunity to fill out customer service surveys if they came into the lobby and whatnot, but I think that actually reaching out to some of these folks that we regulate and trying to get their input on how things would be better for them is something that I really hope to get out of this process.
So we do have, one of the things that's unique about the health department is we have a lot of different types of stakeholders. We have, you know, we feel that the whole community are our stakeholders because they're all, you know, part of our community that we serve. We feel that the people that we, that are sort of customers are our stakeholders and also the agencies that we work with. And so we're really hoping that this survey will reach all of them. It'll be online. As I said, it'll be pretty simple and online, and people will be encouraged to forward it, share it with others, and, you know, multiple people from agencies can fill it out. So hopefully we'll get a lot of good, rich data from that. We'll also be promoting a simpler version of the survey for Carroll County residents. As I said, they're also our stakeholders. So once that's completed, and we encourage you to participate, once that's completed, the committee and I will go back, look at that data, we'll talk to the leadership, and we'll set about kind of creating a picture of where we are with the health department right now and how that matches our vision of where we want to be in 5 years, and then make a plan to get from here to there. So that'll be, hopefully we'll have a plan ready in the spring. And once that's ready, then as Ed mentioned, we'll be doing more quality improvement and performance management pieces. So that same group or, you know, some additional employees will be sort of heading forward with our strategic plan and looking at more ways to do some quality improvement and performance projects. So
one of the reasons that I wanted to put this information in front of you guys today is because if eventually we do move forward with accreditation, the Board of Health needs to concur with our strategic plan. So at some point in time, once we've gotten further along in this process, you guys, this isn't the first time you're seeing it, we'll be telling you about what we've come up with as we work through the process. And at some point in time, especially if we move forward with accreditation, we would need endorsement by this body to say, yeah, we're okay with your strategic plan and where you're taking the health department.
Now, is your strategic plan part of the governor's initiative here to be customer friendly in this whole initiative as far as your stakeholders dealing with the average person out here? Is this part of that, or is
it's,
this
it's separate? Not. This is a health department initiative. You know, we've talked when you all interviewed me, one of the things I said was most important to me was customer service. And the strategic planning part, I didn't really even think about that from the customer service standpoint until we started getting going with it, and Maggie showed me what she was doing, and I was like, well, this is great because I want to do that too, and it's all part of this. So it's a health department initiative that nobody's pushing us to necessarily do. It's something that we thought as our leadership, as we brought them together, all of our bureau chiefs, and me personally thought was an important thing to work on that we hadn't been focusing on before. It's I don't know. I think that you know, we tended to live on a day to, you know, how people live paycheck to paycheck. Well, we were living day to day operating the health department, and we were doing a very effective job of doing that because we have some really good staff that are capable of running their programs. But trying to look at it from the broader perspective, the one thing that I think we've really done a good job with, and I'll brag about it as the health officer here, is being able to pull our leadership together. And have us, I would say 3 or 4 years ago, if we had a funding issue, that it would have been very difficult for me to say to the nursing, you guys have this person who's retiring, and environmental health, you have this person that's retiring, and we really need this position, and we need to pull that money together. And everybody was kind of working in their own little silos on their own little piece. And what we're trying to do is work together collectively as a health department. Everybody, and I think we're doing a good job at this, of collaborating with each other, because we've always had a lot of good external collaboration, but collaborating with each other to support each other and make sure that we're delivering what the community really needs, as opposed to you know, trying to look at our own little areas. So I think that's where we're trying to head with this, and we want to provide the best based on, and it kind of gets into the next thing that I'm going to talk about, based on, you know, the resources that we're given, we want to provide. We can't give everything to the community that we'd like to give to the community, but based on the resources of the that we're given, what does the community really need, and how can we provide that? So that's what we're trying to do, and it's not driven by anything at the state level. This is just something that we, as an organization, thought was important to do, and Maggie's taken on the tough task of trying to keep everybody's, you know, everybody focuses on their job a lot, and it's really hard when you're talking about this high-level planning type of stuff, because it's not the immediate issue that you have to deal with today. it's really hard to keep everybody's attention and focus on this, and I think she's doing a great job. You know, sometimes I have to pull her into our leadership meetings because our folks are so focused on the opioid epidemic, or, you know, one of the things that's rising to the top anymore is dental issues, or, you know, we might have a spike in certain types of diseases or something going on from an emergency standpoint. But trying to keep everybody focused on moving this plan forward is something that's important, so that ultimately, you know, we have a long-range plan and we're providing the best services we can over the long term, as opposed to just being able to provide the services that are needed on a day-to-day basis. So that's kind of why we're headed that way and where we're going with this. Does that make sense?
Maggie, I love your initiative and your planning on this. You know, now I'm going to jump ahead just a second here. You know, we do hear a lot of complaints about things, and Commissioner Wance has been with me. I know we've been bombarded and things. That's Health Department, even though it has a Carroll County name on, that's the state of Maryland. But yet, we have starting our initiative here with Carroll County Friendly, and I know the governor has a whole initiative going out or has been. And if you've been to DMV lately, it's a whole different atmosphere. That's the atmosphere I would like to see Carroll County have here in the near future, and I hope the Health Department is part of that. As far as, and I know you have regulations, and people do not like regulations, and no matter what you do, it's going to be controversial, but it's the way you present it sometimes that and the person who's out there may get somewhat attacked verbally, at least for what they're doing, but they have to do certain things. So I hope this all part of the training goes down to the person that's meeting the public out here, and this we get a whole different refocus on this. And I know it's going to come from us. It's coming from the governor. I hope the Health Department is part of that. And this falls right in line with what you're coming up with.
We definitely consider the, you know, when we're aware of, you know, all the state initiatives and, you know, wanted to do our own survey so we could ask more specific questions. But certainly I think one of the things that we added, we had a mission and vision, but we didn't have value statements before. And so in addition to sort of choosing those along with the staff and the leadership, we've been sort of promoting them with our staff and encouraging staff to come up with examples of staff exemplifying those values and putting them up on a bulletin board and things like that. So we're, you know, in addition to sort of asking our customers and getting feedback from them, we're also making sure that our employees know what's important to us, that those values that they're using and acting in with the public, and making sure that those are really upheld as, you know, sort of, you know.
Do you have training in place for this?
So we are working on training, but we're certainly, you know, we're continuing to, you know, sort of promote these values and looking for other ways to help train people and just recognize people who are really upholding.
And it's hard. So. I understand that, but it's something that we have to. It's a mindset as much as anything.
Regulation with a smile. Yeah.
Well, and, you know, the bottom line is it's just so much. I don't know. I put it in plain English as far as I'm concerned. It's so much easier to collaborate with people and work together on something than to be more directive. And I guess the thing is, try to guide the staff. And not every personality is going to fit your mold, but we try to guide the staff in the direction of working together with folks to try to help them achieve what they want, and try to find a way to work through some of these requirements. Because some of the regulatory requirements, as you're well aware, can be burdensome on businesses and individuals and whatnot. One of the values I try to instill in the staff is trying to find a way to meet somebody halfway and figure out a way that they can get what they want with still meeting what legal requirements we have to enforce. So, yeah. Henry, I think you had something you wanted to add.
Well, Ed's being a little bit modest, but one thing, having sat in his chair and had discussions prior and during his hiring, we're blessed to have a stable traditional public health system, but Ed's leadership in this and his energy and enthusiasm is really, I think, to be commended, and he's picked this up and carried it forward, period. I wanted to acknowledge that. I do think, Commissioner Weaver, that we are in the middle of a context that is changing, hopefully for the better. I think Ed's point's very true, that this isn't some governor top-down program of which we have to deal with a number. This really is owned and managed by Maggie. I keep having my crazy ideas, but it's really the staff committees who are driving what's happening, the way in which the values were developed, go into the men's room and you see a little chart up there that lists the values and the vision. There's a really frontline feeling to this. The other county I work in Cecil County, they did go for accreditation. And for 3 years, most of the agency was consumed with paperwork and trying to check off the right boxes. Those of you who have been through strategic planning exercises, we've all been there and done that. I see this actually leading to what you referenced there, Commissioner, as really building the capacity of the health department. If it's successful, the benefit will be that we will not only have a stronger vision of how we work together, but each program will know that they're important, and each staff person will know that, and the stakeholders. But it'll take 5 to 10 years to really see that.
Yeah, regulation with a smile is good. I like that.
So if there's no other questions for Maggie, you can stay, because I don't have anybody else to bring back up unless you want to go. The last thing that I put it in here in the presentation as county funding, and I guess I was sitting with Secretary Schrader when we're trying to solve a problem of Shoemaker Center, and fortunately the Department of Health has been very helpful in us maintaining that residential treatment unit down there, and it benefits Carroll County immensely having it there, because a lot of times, and we were talking about this in the Behavioral Health Advisory Council meeting the other night, a lot of times if they've got a space and we're able to jam somebody in there ahead of anybody else because our hospital's right here and they get a person in there today. So it's an advantage having it here in our county, even though it's open to the entire state, and it keeps people relatively local, and it helps us keep a little eye on where they're going in the system of care so that we don't lose them dropping out somewhere between going from residential treatment to, you know, the next level down and the next level down. So anyway, but the secretary said something to me that kind of struck a nerve, and that was, well, really it's a partnership between the state and the county, the local health department is. And different health departments are set up different ways, and some of them are locally run and whatnot, but there are resources that you guys put into the health department, and I view it, and different health officers may have different views on this, but I think the secretary is right, and that is that we should consider this to be a partnership with the county. And even though we're a state agency and you guys don't necessarily directly control everything that we do, I feel a responsibility to you all as a board of commissioners and as a board of health to make sure that the health department is at least moving in a direction that that you all think is reasonable. So the piece about the funding that I wanted to mention is, you know, you give us a significant amount of money in our county budget, roughly $3.4 million in FY18. But we've always focused on what does that pay for? And we talk about it paying for our administration bureau and our environmental health bureau. Well, yeah, in the line items in the whole big health department budget, that's where the money essentially goes to, a lot of it. But there's $13.4 million in additional funds that come from the state, the federal government, and private grants that is essentially leveraged by the contribution that you all give to the health department. And, you know, we use some of the money you give us to match other grants, whether it's in our behavioral health unit and substance use. You know, this allows us to be partnering with the detention center and partnering with the law enforcement and partnering with the state's attorney's office and working with Access Carroll and Citizen Services and going after some of these federal grants that are beneficial, like our CHES grant that we've talked to you about before, and the grant that we're that we're really seeing the need for mental health for young ages, that's going to be $1 million a year that we got from SAMHSA that we're going to be getting off the ground. And you know, if it weren't for the personnel support, and, you know, you look at it and it's like, well, we're paying for administrative support. Well, if it weren't for the personnel support in the state system and the IT support that we have at the health department, and, you know, procurement and contracting and all that we need to, and I guess just, you know, paying for the health officer to help coordinate some of these efforts, you know, if it weren't for the money and the resources that the county's putting into the health department, there'd be no way we could leverage all these other things that we're doing that benefit our community. So everything from our safety net programs to public health emergency preparedness to what we're doing with our women's, infants, and children's program, providing birth certificates. Everything else we do in the health department is leveraged by the support that the commissioners provide to us. And we met with our budget analyst, and I know we cycle through budget analysts because Roberta tells me that the health department's actually a relatively easy budget. It's not complicated. It's complicated from us, but from a county standpoint, it's not very complicated. But we talked to our budget analyst, and Chizuko came along, who was our former budget analyst, to kind of bridge the gap, which is good, about how this year when we give you our budget, we're not going to give you a formal presentation because I didn't feel like we had the need to do that. But when we give you our budget submission, I want to not only focus on what the county money directly pays for, but what else that gets you as far as services to our citizens in Carroll County, and not just focus on these are the line items that the county money pays for, but this is what you're actually getting out of it, as opposed to focusing on those administrative and costs and things that aren't necessarily all related to what the money actually gets for the citizens of Carroll County. So I just wanted to let you know that that's what you can expect to see in our budget submission, and that I think that it's an important thing to recognize that we're not just talking about those line items in the health department's budget that these funds pay for, but it's everything else that we do and are able to leverage in the community. So I'll leave it at that. If you have any questions, I'd be glad to answer them. Otherwise, you guys can be done as a Board of Health, and we'll get out of your hair.
So any questions?
So the budget should be based on the amount of accommodations and complaints we get, right?
You know,
with
I don't know that too many people call you to compliment us, but I wish they would. I get feedback on staff a lot, and I do get a lot of positive comments, and you know, I think trying to look some of the stuff that Maggie's doing from a strategic planning standpoint, and talking to the people that we work with, it's important to me. Not only what each individual thinks of us and how those interactions go, that's very important, but also our community partners. I want to feel like that what we're doing with them brings a lot of value to the things that they do. And there's none of this anymore that we can all do on our own. It's a matter of the collaboration and making things work together. And I like to think that the health department's a key partner with a lot of the folks that we work with. And I know the regulatory piece is tough, and I know that we can do better, I want to focus on that. You know, some of the things that I think are important that we may have gotten away from a little bit, and I want to talk to Lee and work on, is if you're proactive and you reach out to the regulated community in some cases and you talk to them about what the requirements are and why they are and how we can work together better, sometimes there's some give and take as to how those, for instance, the realtors is probably an example, and I don't know whether I think I got it from Delegate Krebs more than I got it from you, Commissioner Wance, but I know we used to go out and routinely talk to the Board of Realtors on a regular basis about, well, this is why we have some of these issues and what can we do to improve that. And I think, you know, it's just having the conversations with some of these groups that are out here in the community when we might be having difficulty with customer service can help resolve some of those issues. And I think that's something that we need to work on.
And don't get me wrong, we do get some positive comments too. So it's not all negative. You just don't hear those. But it's a lot of good things going on.
You're going to provoke them into another speech now, Commissioner. Yeah.
And with that, I'm going to move that we adjourn as Department of Health today.
Board of Health.
Good God, get it right, yeah.
As Board of Commissioners.
Yeah.
Yes. So what, I have a second on that.
Yeah, put it
second.
There.
All right. Any further discussion?
No, although I'm confused by that motion. Now.
Yeah. Don't ask me to repeat it.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Thank you very much.
Thank you all for your time.
Thank you all very much. Thank Keep you. Up the good work.
Yep. Thanks, Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas Thanks, to all Adam. Of you.
All right, the next item we're going to talk about is the future of the former Army Reserve building. This is the discussion we want to have out in an open session about what our plans are for that building, so everyone is kind of knowing what we're moving forward with.
Saheed.
Anybody want to jump in?
I thought that what precipitated this was concern over some of the operational funding concerns. Is that right?
Yes.
Okay, so I'll kick it off, then you guys can take it from there. But just to recap, we gained control of the Army Reserve facility, decided it would be a very nice thing to do for our veterans, for our community, for our county, to make this capital asset, which is worth millions of dollars, available to service our veterans. But I think there was an implicit assumption when we did that, that while we were donating the capital facility and helping them perhaps get some grants to work on the building, we had not in any way, shape, or form intended to suggest or imply that we would in any way, shape, or form be funding any operational aspects of operating it, that was all to be done through a nonprofit organization. And I think that, I don't want to put words in anybody's mouth, but I think that the concern was that we want to make it clear that we do not have the funds to provide operational support for this building. So if they're going to move forward with the capital asset that we've donated to this, a very generous donation, it is incumbent on the groups that are operating it to provide 100% of the operating funds, and they should not come to the county expecting us to subsidize them in any way, shape, or form. Gentlemen, does that capture the essence of what we...
Well, presently, they have developed a 501c3. They have their own funding or budget set up there. They are operating separate from the county. All we need to do is the designation and the, I guess, the renting of the facility for how we handle that for X amount of dollars a year or something, and how we handle it. But they have set this up and are moving forward with it. I don't think we have funding responsibility.
Right. I think one of the main reasons for the discussion is to make sure everyone's on the same page that the funding for ongoing operations at this building will be done by the nonprofit that's running the facility, and not by Carroll County. Do we have the designation changed for the buildings that they can use it? So that's not done yet.
Was that sent to the federal government yet?
Cool. Sent today.
Okay, so it's been sent. So once that designation gets changed, if it does, then the building we can lease it or rent it to the organization for a very minimal price. But their day-to-day operations are in their hands. We're not looking to fund this in the future. We will help them, I guess, like you said, with grants and that kind of stuff. But funding from the county is not in our plan, right now.
And they have already asked the state delegation for a bond, correct?
Well, that's a concern to us. if they are successful in getting that bond and then are not successful in continuing their operations, then the county, would more likely than not be on the hook for either reimbursing the state or continuing to operate it for the next 15 or 20 years.
Yeah, that's the concern.
That's a very large concern for us.
That's the challenge for me. If they are successful in getting all the funding and get this thing going, which is great, but let's be clear, none of us are speaking negatively about the fact that it's going to be there. But suppose their efforts and the resources that they have dry up, then what happens? Somebody's going to have to step in, because it's going to be looked upon as a negative thing if it just says, okay, well, they're out of money now, so they shut it down. So I'm concerned about, should we be looking at putting some monies into the budget 5-6 years out just to supplement a little bit of it, or just let them do it on their own basis? Because again, I don't want to put the county in a position that if something happens to it, then it's just shut down, and that's not a good thing at all.
No, I think that's.
And I also question a lot of the resources. Where are they going to get people to run if it indeed does become a shelter? Who are they pulling people from to run a shelter? I'm pretty sure our citizen services doesn't have the people to be able to do that. And if they do, we'd have to hire them.
Well,
so there's just there's so many. Again, I'm not trying to make this sound negative, but there's just so many unanswered questions moving forward.
Christine, are you familiar with how they were planning to operate on that?
No. Get up to the mic and say no.
Just get up, say no, and sit down.
I don't think they've gotten that far, to be honest.
Okay, that's fine. And make it clear, we're obviously supportive of what they're trying to do, as evidenced by the fact we're trying to turn the building over to them. But I want to make it clear, there is no money in this budget, next year's, even 5 years out for it, nor are there any intentions to appropriate any monies. One of the things that I think is missing, and they'll get to it, we're rooting for them, is they probably really need to put together their own 5-year operating plan to show how they're going to fund their operations for the next 5 years. Because if they can't make it look like it's going to work even on paper, then it's not going to work in reality.
That may be a request from the commissioners.
Right. That plan would have to go forward before they get any state grants or anything that we're responsible for matching or that matches are required. Because the fact is, if they get a state grant and they don't have the money to match it, where's it going to come to? It's going to come to us. So therefore, that 5-year plan has to be in place first. And additionally, my original thought about this building wasn't that it was just a shelter. It was other services for veterans that they might need. Kind of like, I don't call it a one-stop shop, but veterans could come in for other things as well, not just a shelter.
I agree 100%. The shelter was just a small piece. We thought it was going to provide other suite of services to help veterans. And quite frankly, I've seen some statistics, I don't know if they're correct, saying that the number of homeless veterans in the county could be counted on one hand with fingers left over. So we got to make it clear that we better not create a service for which there's no need. They need to make sure that they know what their audience is, they know what their market is, they know what the services they're providing, they know where their funding's coming from. So this thing is a success and not a failure coming out of the gate.
Yeah. It was built as a resource center, right?
Right.
I think that's what I got out of it. Which leads to perhaps other funding that would be available for other parts of it, not just a shelter.
Right.
Well, that's part of it. I mean, I would assume the Mad Dog shuttle would be part of operate from there, maybe, or could be picked up, dropped off at that point. No, maybe.
I think they need to define their mission better. Right. They've asked for a building. Now they've got a building. Now what are you going to do with it? Just tell us what you're going to do with it, what the component services are going to be, what the market is for those component services, and how you're going to fund it. It's that simple.
I mean, being the commissioner for this district, I'm not interested in seeing yet another shelter, just a shelter, come into the city of Westminster. Now, if there's a need for 4 or 5 shelter, veterans to be sheltered there and so forth, fine. But the main idea of this building was for a resource center to help veterans out with other problems,
and
not
then
just
rehabilitation
shelter.
If they needed help.
That's got to be rolled in there. They got to have services there, training, everything should be in there. That's my understanding of why we put this forward. Shelter was like the end of the thing. If it was needed, we need shelter, but now shelter seems to have come up to the front of it, and that's not my understanding of why we took this on in the first place.
Well, you have to have some stability before you move to the second part.
I agree with that completely, but it's not my understanding when we first talked about it, it's not completely. The main purpose of this is not a shelter.
Yeah.
The main purpose of this is to help veterans in other ways.
And keep in mind, I think you have all the American Legions, VFWs, some other foundations kicking money in now, and that's small amount probably for what they need, but yet it's several $100,000 coming in their budget presently. I know they were presented with a $15,000 check just the other day, so there is some funds coming in at this point.
There's also another issue that when Mr. Valenti was here last, I think, he mentioned the idea of creating a little village of tiny houses on the property.
That's a zoning
issue. We need to identify that is not currently allowed in the zoning anywhere. If you'd like, we can draft a letter that outlines some of the things that you guys have discussed today, just to make sure that everybody's on the same page, that they know what the zoning is and what limitations there are,
that they know what our, that we're supportive, but that our concerns are that they need, you know, to make that they, when push comes to shove, when we have to actually make the decision that this facility will be turned over to them, or that they're going to be able to provide us with information such as their five-year operating plan, their funding, you know, resources, and give you assurances to make sure that, that the county will feel comfortable going forward.
Could we ask that they, as part of this, these are things they address, come in and address the board? On their planning, at least they would.
I think it's premature at this point, I would say. I mean, when we're ready to, when...
Well, we have to wait for the building to be redesignated first.
We don't even know if the building will be redesignated.
If and when that happens, and then they could come out. And, but the essential is a five-year plan and the vision for what this building is going to be used for.
Yeah.
Those two things are, I think, essential.
Yeah, and they and then they would at that point.
Okay.
All right. Any further discussion?
No, I think that's a good idea.
All right, then we're going to move on to approval of minutes. Glad I have this agenda here. Okay, we have minutes for Thursday, November 30th at 10 a.m.
Move we approve.
Second.
Quick.
You guys read this or something?
Yep.
Yeah. It's minutes. You're supposed to.
You're behind.
I'd like to say just one thing about it. On page 4 of the minutes of November 30th at 10 a.m., the motion was so long that we ran out of space. And
did Howard make that motion?
It was so long that we ran out of space. Do you see what I'm saying?
Yes.
So we put it above and we have written space in the middle. The motion
okay.
is here, right above it.
See it.
Just for your
yeah, the program only allows just so
much. Yeah,
right.
That's fine.
Just want to make sure. You know.
All right. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Okay, for minutes for December 14th at 10 a.m.
Move to approve.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
I'll abstain.
Is that all we have? That's it. All right, agendas.
Yes.
Yeah.
Try to keep up.
Jeez.
Yeah, we're up to
Ms. Administrator,
we're done,
try
right?
to keep up.
All right. Okay, the week of December 25th to December 26th, county offices will be closed. We have nothing scheduled for that week except Sunday, December 31st, Commissioner's report from Commissioner Howard. Week two, we have Monday, January 1st, county offices closed for New Year's Day. On Wednesday, January 3rd, Planning and Zoning Commission work session, county office building. I guess that will be Commissioner Wentz now, correct? Don't look so happy about it, but yes. All right.
You asked for it.
All right. Thursday, January 4th, Carroll County Chamber of Commerce Legislative Breakfast in New Windsor with Commissioner Rothschild. At 10 o'clock, we have our session. We're going to start with the Hampstead annexation number 41, which we discussed today. I guess that they will have to vote on it. We'll go into request approval to accept a grant for a foundation grant. We'll go on to regional approval to submit application for regional training grant for the Governor's Office for Children, Department of Citizen Services. We have a request approval to accept the Family Self-Sufficiency Grant. We have a Chapter 170 Construction Code modifications. Go on to a bid approval for preventative generator maintenance. We move to a bid approval for Northern Landfill Cell 3 subcell. I'm sure we'll find out a lot about that. We go on to a bid approval for Charles Carroll Elementary School demolition and a bid approval for Court Smart System and audio video refresh for the Department of Technology Services. On Thursday, January 4th, Carroll County Farm Bureau Legislative Dinner with Commissioner Weaver, Howard, and Rothschild. On Saturday, January 6th, Carroll County Education Association Legislative Breakfast in Westminster with Frazier, Weaver, Howard, and Rothschild. And on Sunday the 7th, we have the commissioner's report with Commissioner Wance. Anybody have anything else?
Yes, I do.
That really was a rhetorical question.
Sorry, it'll be quick. Just so you all know, we've received at least one inquiry. With the new passage of the tax bill that was just passed by Congress, there in 2018 and beyond, there will be limits on what you can deduct for state and local taxes on your federal taxes, as I understand it. There are some people talking out there in the community with, 10 more days, whatever left in the year, if you pay the taxes, your 2018.
In 17.
17, 18 taxes before 2017 finishes, that you might be able to deduct the full amount and you wouldn't be limited to the $10,000. The state of Maryland at one point gave jurisdictions enabling legislation that allowed them to accept prepayment of taxes. Carroll County has never authorized that. We've never passed our own local ordinance allowing us to accept the prepayment of taxes or early payment of taxes. That you are finished for your year. You have no more sessions. It would take advertising, and notice to the public to change your ordinance. So basically, there is no way Carroll County could accept.
Well, let me just ask a question. The taxes are due July 1st, aren't they?
Taxes
property
are
taxes?
Not due until after they're billed, which also adds an element of complication to the whole issue. And tax advisors I've heard are split on the issue as to whether or not this would, and there are no regulations whether this would actually work for folks. But if you get an inquiry, Carroll County, unfortunately, never passed that enabling legislation, so we can't accept prepayment of taxes.
It couldn't be done for the fiscal year? Instead of the,
it would have to be done before the end of 2017.
Oh, for the
December 21st of 2017, and you have no more sessions, and there's no time for notice and advertising, public hearings, and all that kind of stuff that you would have to have in order to pass an election.
Well, what is only 10 days to advertise?
I was kidding.
Days.
Please, but
yeah.
It's a joke.
Yeah.
Okay, just in case it comes up.
Monday.
Not doing anything on Monday, are you?
Well, okay.
Well, didn't the legislation, let me rephrase, all I know is what I'm reading in the media. Who knows if that's accurate? But I thought that the bill was amended to prohibit deductions for prepayment of state and local income taxes. We were suggesting that the property tax prepayment you're looking at me funny.
Yeah, I'm listening.
I heard, I think it was on television. Well, I don't know if it's true. What I heard was that the bill had been amended to prohibit the prepayment of state and local income taxes in December of 17. But I did not hear that they would, that the bill was being mod to prevent the prepayment of property taxes.
I'm not saying the federal bill was. What I'm saying is, although the state of Maryland, some number of years ago,
I get that,
allowed counties to offer that as an option, Carroll County has never taken that option. We've never passed any legislation to allow the prepayment of taxes in Carroll, and therefore, we can't accept it.
There's nothing that prohibits it, though, right?
But wait a minute.
We're not authorized
to accept it. Wait a minute. Somebody, hang on a second. If somebody writes a check on December 27th, hang on, I just want to talk this through because it's going to affect a lot of people. I know you don't want to hear it, but we got to talk it out. And the check arrives in the county office building on January 2nd. Somebody opens the envelope. Now, before anything happens with that check, that person has technically triggered a deduction for themselves because from their standpoint, they have disbursed the funds on December 27th. Couldn't we instruct the comptroller, given this unusual circumstances, to just hold those checks until we can amend act on the enabling legislation in January, then deposit them after the enabling legislation is passed in late January?
No.
Why?
Process-wise, he has no mechanism for holding it.
He puts it in a box and holds it.
There's your process.
It's yeah, dope. No. I mean, it just is fraught with lots of danger and
what would that danger be?
Well, just accounting for it properly, first of all. We don't have any mechanism. We don't...
Checks received but not deposited.
We don't keep... The tax bills are not per person. They're per property, and there's no way to match it up. I mean, I can have Rob Burke come in and tell you. Basically, no. I get that
it would be awkward, but I don't see why we can't receive checks and notify people that we're holding them until we pass the legislation.
Doesn't pay their full amount because they'd be just guessing.
Then we'll process what we have and we'll send them. You still owe us $50 yeah. bucks. Big yeah. deal. This is not rocket science.
We don't accept partial payment. I know that. It's got
to
be
full.
We're
not unable to do so.
Well, I think we could do it if we wanted to.
We don't have enabling legislation passed.
I think we could do it. I think nothing stops us from taking checks.
Because the state of Maryland, the state of Maryland said you have to pass enabling legislation to do it.
Which we did not do.
The state of Maryland, and you never did it. So.
You know what?
All right.
If somebody mails a check in on the 31st of December and it gets mailed back to them on January 10th, technically they've rendered the payment in December, and then they can treat it as income in 2018 when it comes back. No, I'm that.
Okay, anything else? Need a motion to adjourn?
No. Motion to adjourn.
Second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Adjourned.
See you next year.
Want to stay informed about Carroll County government? Follow us on Facebook by searching for Carroll County Government.